executive session. I move. Go ahead and call the roll.
Chairman Hart?
Aye.
Representative Cross?
Here.
Representative Bondin?
Here.
Representative Hanson?
Here.
Representative Hicks? Representative LaFever?
Here.
Representative Lant?
Here.
Representative McDonald? Representative Munzel?
Here.
Representative Pace?
Here.
Representative Rowden? Representative Zaire?
Here.
Now that we have quorum, I will move us into the executive session. Move that we do pass HJR 5, Representative Redmond's bill. Any discussion? Seeing none, please call the roll.
Chairman Hart?
Aye.
Representative Cross?
Aye.
Representative Bondin?
Aye.
Representative Hanson?
Aye.
Representative Hicks? Representative LaFever?
Aye.
Representative Lant?
Aye.
Representative McDonald? Representative Munzel?
Aye.
Representative Pace?
Aye.
Representative Rowden? And Representative Zaire?
Here.
Aye. I'm here too.
By your vote of 9-0, we do pass House Bill Resolution 5. I move that we do pass House Bill 583. Recognize Representative Cross.
Thank you. I do have an amendment that ends point 2L. And I move for its adoption.
Any discussion on the amendment? Representative LaFever.
If, may I inquire, Representative Cross?
Go ahead.
Can you explain your amendment somewhere?
Sure. In a court of law, let's say somebody is falling on one of those times and they've been evicted. They lost their job. In a court of law, let's say maybe a gentleman has fallen on hard times, you know, divorce or lost their job or unemployed or something that would cause, put them in a situation where they can no longer really uphold the lease, okay? Well, if they're evicted in a court of law, what this means is this. Maybe this person is not a trouble tenant, a problem tenant. Maybe it's just because they can't pay it. He can come back to the property. Let's say he wants to be in for a weekend with his brother to watch the Super Bowl or something like that. He must have written authorization from either the landlord or the property management organization in a maximum of 72 hours. And in a sense, it's kind of like, you know, what parental rights or visitation, or it is, in a sense. I wouldn't say it's exactly like the rights in the middle of favor, but I mean, I'm trying to make exceptions for people that fall on hard times.
So what was it before and what are you doing now?
Well, before was, what I was doing was basically in the court of law, I'm trying to prevent it if somebody has been evicted in the court of law from moving back in somewhere, and they have to come back to the village place, and maybe a problem tenant. And as a result, his name's on the lease, he shouldn't be on the property if he's been evicted in the court of law.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Representative Zaire. Go ahead.
Thank you. Representative, if they can petition to or ask in writing to visit on a weekend, do you have any limit per year about how many times they can visit?
It's just today, let's say this weekend's the Super Bowl. In June, there's a birthday.
Okay, so there's no limit.
Why? There could be an anniversary.
Okay.
If they call the landlord or the property manager, gets a written notice, you know. That's fine.
Okay.
I'm trying to protect those people who've just fallen on hard times.
Yeah, thank you.
That was the purpose of it.
Thank you, Representative.
Thank you. Representative Pace?
Thank you. To inquire, please.
Go ahead.
Yes, Representative. I was wondering, at what point in time, say for instance, you have to issue a written, I guess a written letter, or can you call?
You can call the landlord, call the association. You know, Mr. Jones, this is John Smith. You know, I used to rent from you. I'm no longer there. This weekend is my brother's birthday. I'd like to come. I'm asking for your authorization, you know, to visit him. I will probably stay for, you know, Friday and Saturday. May I have your written authorization?
Or is there a contingency plan if you can't reach the manager or whomever at these places?
Ma'am, lady, the only thing I can do is offer an alternative that they will need to notify these, you know, and you know, whether it's in writing or whether they call this person, if they don't reach them, then I guess there's really nothing I can do.
So they're going to be available
24/7?
Is that what you're saying?
No. I don't know if it's available 24/7.
Have you said so hours or what?
Okay, you can call during hours, you can leave a message, because lots of times, you know, whether you're trying to call your insurance agent for a claim, he may not be available, or you leave a message, you know. John Smith, reason for my call, you know. I'd like to have written authorization, asking for written authorization to be at my brother's place this weekend, watch Super Bowl, whatever, you know.
So is there a time frame that particular individual should be giving them?
I wouldn't say there's a time frame. I'm just saying in simple terms that they need to notify the landlord, and it's his written authorization. I mean, you know, so.
I understand, but I mean, it could be past the time frame that they're asking for that request, so
they don't. Well, if they don't get the written authorization, there's really nothing I can do. I'm trying to offer another option.
I understand, but at the same token, it may not help in those situations.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other discussion? Representative Hansen?
Yeah, just to inquire the member.
Go ahead.
This is geared more towards, I understand this bill originally, if you had somebody, if you had a trouble getting somebody out of an apartment for 2 or 3 months because they weren't paying their bills, they've been a problem, you finally got them out, you finally got them evicted, and this was a chance basically to say, if you want to come back here to see somebody, you need to get permission because they were not cooperating to start with by paying their bill. Is that correct?
That is correct, sir.
Okay, and then the difference between your amendment and this bill originally was in the bill, it said at any time they could come back in. Your bill limits it that they have to get permission and they're limited to 72 hours. That's the difference.
That is correct. That's correct, sir.
Thank you. Further discussion on the amendment, Representative Hicks.
That is exactly how the amendment is read, and that's exactly how I agree with it as well. Being a landowner and a landlord, it's very hard not to be able to get a hold of a landlord, a manager, or someone on the premises. There's almost someone there 24 hours a day. Now, I think I understand what you're saying, and that would be as if it was, you know, a last-minute, spur-of-the-minute thing. It may be a little bit more difficult, especially if someone's not at the residence as far as a manager, assistant manager, a landowner, or something like that goes. But the way the bill was written before, there was nothing that helped them out. And I can see that this amendment here will help. It will help. And it gives them 72 hours, too. You know, we had discussions of just a day or 24 hours or something like that. But, you know, grandma may want the family around for the whole weekend or something like that, and that's when we came up with the 72-hour part of it.
Further discussion of the amendment?
I just want to comment on that, too. Yeah, I do know some apartments that are not, the management is not available, you know, on weekends and what have you, too. So, I mean, we have a gray area there on those instances. But I do agree that the bill is somewhat better than what it was.
I would have to say in an apartment building where the manager's not there, that's where this might even help a little bit more, to tell you the truth, because I don't know about you, but I wouldn't want them on the premises unless I knew they were going to be there. Now, and I know this isn't for everyone. We're mainly trying to focus this and point the finger more towards the person that was the problem, that we literally had to use the cords and things to remove them from our apartment buildings and such, but... You know, that the standard everyday person is going to have a relationship probably with a manager, assistant manager, or landowner, someone anyway. This is going more towards the problem side of it.
Well, I can understand that too, but I think it lessens the opportunity to be able to get in touch with the manager to get that permission for them to be able to get on the premises as well. So, thank you.
I understand your side too.
Okay. Further discussion on the amendment? Seeing none. All those in favor of House Amendment 1 to House Bill 583, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say no.
No.
Ayes clearly have it. We'll now vote on the underlying bill. Please call roll.
Chairman Hart.
Aye.
Representative Cross.
Aye.
Representative Bondin.
Aye.
Representative Hansen.
I have a point of order here. Are we voting on the amendment rolled into the
bill? The bill has amended.
Bill has amended, okay, aye.
Representative Hicks?
Aye.
Representative LaFaver?
Yes.
Representative Lant?
Aye.
Representative McDonald? Representative Munzel?
Aye.
Representative Pace?
No.
Representative Rowden?
Aye.
Representative Zaire?
Aye.
Representative LaFaver?
Aye.
By your vote of 10 yes and 1 no, we have do pass House Bill 583. I now move us out of executive session and on to the main event. Representative Hinson.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Representative Dave Hinson representing the 119th District. Pretty sure that this bill will last a little bit longer than the 3 minutes as my previous bill did last week in your committee. House Bill 800 is the Missouri Compassionate Care Act. This bill allows a patient-doctor relationship to take place for patients who are suffering from a debilitating disease. As we all know, we've all had family members, or maybe yourselves, that have tried medications, but they haven't worked specifically for you and your illness. What this bill does is allow the patient and doctor to have a relationship with their treatment plan to be able to access medical cannabis. This bill is very regulated because none of us want the Colorado experience. And that's what this bill does not do, is allow for that. This bill is very regulated in the case that it must be grown and distributed from a care center that is only accessible to those patients that have a prescription per se from the doctor and have been given a medical card from the Department of Health of the state of Missouri. This bill allows for those patients that are in a debilitating condition to be able to hopefully have some ease in whatever pain or discomfort that they have. This bill does not allow for the use of medical marijuana or cannabis in the presence of others. It must be done where it does not cause any harm to anyone that's near them. This bill allows for people that were similar in my father's situation. In 1989, my father was diagnosed with cancer. And during that process, we found out that he had bone cancer. Very debilitating disease, was given 12 months to live, he made it 10 months. And all I can remember is the last 2 months of his life that he was so endowed with morphine that he was so sick to his stomach and all he wished to do was die. And towards his last days, he would hit the morphine button so many times that the pump would just stop working. And in that time, he was so high on morphine that he was seeing little green people walk on the ceiling. So I gotta ask you, what's the difference between that or a patient that could have some dignity in their last days with comfort and compassion? And that's what this bill does. This bill allows for people that may not be in a dying state, but may be suffering from effects from chemotherapy, where they're not able to hold food down. They're so sick to their stomach that they're losing weight. And we all hear the jokes about cannabis, that, you know, it causes have the munchies. Well, that's what we want for these people that are suffering through chemotherapy. I've had so many people since this bill has been filed that I had no idea that would have ever even thought about using cannabis that have come to me and told me that it had helped them through a phase in their life where they were going through treatment for chemotherapy and they were so sick to their stomach that they couldn't keep food down and they didn't know what to do. One gentleman that very well known person in my county, very well respected, that I remembered that he had cancer a few years ago and that he recovered from it, basically told me that if it wasn't for a friend of his giving him the story about this friend's mother using it and encouraging him to try it, that he probably wouldn't have been here today, because his only option that he was thinking about was suicide, because he was so sick to his stomach, it was withering away because he couldn't keep food down. And that's just some stories that I have heard. The overwhelming support that I've gotten today, that from one of our colleagues that we have, and some of you will be able to, hopefully he'll share his story with you all in private, just like he did me. But it's amazing how we are all touched. Everyone in this room has been touched by an episode of probably their family that is suffering through some type of debilitating disease, whether it's cancer, whether it's some type of autoimmune disease, whether it's Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, multiple sclerosis, that all we wanted for them is some relief. And what this does is it gives them the ability, through their doctors, to have a relationship where they can access this. And Mr. Chairman, I'd be happy to go through the bill line by line or open it up for questions from the committee.
Questions for the witness? Representative LaFaber. Go ahead.
Thanks for bringing this forward, Representative. I appreciate it. I have not poured through every line on here, but I've seen the summary and seen a couple other things that are of interest. What's the thinking behind the $25,000 non-refundable license fee?
Sure. Most business owners will tell you that if you're a legit business, that you have to have that to go into a business as it is. My wife and I own a franchise, and so whenever we were researching franchises to possibly invest in, just about every one of them had a $25,000 fee, and you also had to have certain amounts of assets. So to me, if this is going to be a legitimate business, that's not much to ask from people who are legitimizedly in it for the business aspect and not just for.
And so is that where it creates that $25,000 fee? Are we setting up similar to the liquor issue that we've all dealt with in terms of franchises? Is that where that is in here? It's related to franchise law or not?
It has nothing to do with the liquor franchise law, but I'm just
modeled out franchise.
Any type of franchise. If you look at a McDonald's is $1 million, but I mean, if you look at any other general franchises out there, most of them are about $25,000 for once you say, you know, I'm committed to this. It's
who do they pay the fee to? The Secretary of State's office?
They pay it. It'll go into a special fund that will go to the Division of Alcohol and Tobacco to use to implement the law.
And what's the provision in here related to $500,000 in liquid assets? Is that right?
Yeah. I mean, like I said, if you're a legitimate business person, whenever you go to the bank, you're going to have to show that you have some type of assets on the line, and most of them are about $500,000. You know, most small business guys will tell you most of the time you have to put your house on the line whenever you're trying to get a business.
That's usually required through the bank as collateral to make sure that they can come good on a loan or whatever. But this $500,000 isn't for a loan. It's just an asset test. Is that?
Yeah, to make sure that you are basically that this is a legit company that's taking place, and you know, it also requires that you be a resident of Missouri. We don't want people from outside the state coming in, just like we did with the CBD oil.
I think I see your intent. I'm not sure that having $500,000 creates legitimacy. I think that there are probably legitimate business owners or folks who want to get into any sort of business or any market that may not have $500,000 cash on, but that it could be. The other piece that I have questions about, are we not changing the criminal code, or are you adding something in here related to folks who want to grow their own medicine?
No.
So that would still
be against the law.
Be against the law. And so this sets up a parameter where somebody with $500,000 cash and $25,000 in non-refundable license fees is the only person that could enter the market.
Well, gentlemen, let me put it this way. The 25 or the $500,000 in assets, you know, you're no rich person doing that. I mean, I can pretty much tell you that I have more loan debts than I have in assets now. So you could call me a farmer. We all know they're broke.
Maybe you can help me with some of the thinking and why we wouldn't want to allow in here some provision to allow folks to grow their own. If for medicinal purposes, if you've got, if you want to grow a plant or two.
Because it will be Colorado.
Well, Colorado, it would be legal to use it recreationally. Here, if you had the medical, you know, whatever it is, could you be able to grow it and use it yourself? Or are we creating a marketplace that shuts some people out and allows only others to operate for something for medicine that obviously people so desperately need?
Gentlemen, I think it's going to be fairly difficult for physicians to come to the concept unless they have a really tight relationship with their patients to begin with to recommend the use of this. And I just think that this is the slippery slope which you're talking about if we allow this. And there's going to be a gentleman that comes up later to speak to you about his Colorado experience because he was in charge of the division out there when it got dumped in his lap, I believe, in 2009.
Correct. Yeah. Okay. Well, I appreciate the Q&A. I do appreciate you bringing it forward. I think we've got to start somewhere. I'm a little concerned about us creating sort of an elitist market, but I look forward to seeing some conversation going.
Sure.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Representative Zare.
To inquire, please.
Go ahead.
Thank you. Representative, this is prescription only.
Correct.
Okay, so I had a letter from a lady who said, you know, it's a $20 cab ride to get to my doctor or whatever, but I see, and am I right, that they can designate someone to pick up the
correct
prescription.
So the caregiver, they have to designate a person as a caregiver. They have to go through a background check. They have to apply to the Department of Health. They have to have a picture ID, and then whenever they would go to the care center to pick up the prescription, they would have to show the patient's ID card and their ID card, and they would have to have that with them while transporting it, because if they would get pulled over and not have both of those pieces of identification, then they would be breaking the law.
Do you anticipate that the medical cannabis centers would be kind of geographically dispersed around the state?
And it's put in there as far as the Department of Health trying to disseminate where the population of people would might need it. So we don't want it just in the Kansas City, St. Louis areas. You know, it would be up to them to geographically, once they start getting these applications, to be able to say, you know, if you have, say you have 5 and 5 already in the Kansas City regions, you know, they may want to hold back and say, no, we have enough to put a couple down in the southwest corner or something.
Okay, and you mentioned the cultivation and production facilities. So people will be able to grow it here. You're also going to issue 30 licenses for that, or?
Sure, so the
yes.
Cultivation and production facilities and the care centers would be tied together. That way we don't have to worry about any loopholes of transporting the products between, you know, a cultivation center and that. So there would be 30 of those issued statewide, and then what could happen is, so if you have a license for that, you could actually have 2 more licenses to have care centers. So say you would need 3 in St. Charles County, then you could put them in strategic locations there. And that would be the time where there would be transporting issues, and the Division of Alcohol and Tobacco would promulgate the rules on the strict use of that. as far as how they're tagged and transported and sealed.
And one final question is a layperson's question. Is it the THC that helps people? And I'm embarrassed, but do people get high when they take medical marijuana?
It depends on the level that they're at. Some people, if they're going to be using it strictly for the pain, for pain tolerance, then they're probably going to need a higher level of THC. If they're using it for a neurological issue, they're probably just going to need the effects that the cannabinoid has whenever it bonds to the receptor, so they're not going to need the higher level of THC.
Can they use it in several different delivery methods, like smoking a pill, syrup, or oil?
Yeah, the oil. They can also use it in a lozenger over in Europe. Hopefully, it gets brought here as in a like sublingual spray.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Representative Hanson.
You got it.
To inquire.
Go ahead.
You know, I was looking at the fiscal note, you know, and it's kind of unknown. I know this is going on in other states. I think it's stated in some of the literature here, 23 states. When you have these care centers and law enforcement involved, how are we going to arrive at a fiscal note on this thing? I mean, there's a lot of issues here with a lot of zeros when it comes to fiscal note. And then number two, I chair the health insurance committee, and we just passed out of that committee and out of the select committee prescription drug monitoring program. We were the only state out of 50 states that didn't have that monitoring program through our pharmacies. Will we have a prescription drug monitoring program for cannabis through these care centers? And then number three, we have a lot of pharmacies in this state. We're dispensing drugs that have some of the same chemicals in it to help people, like medical marijuana. Why can't we designate this through some pharmacies and not have to set up separate places? I don't know if that's possible, but the monitoring side of it, what's going to keep me from going down the street and getting stuff from one doctor and then going to the other care center and getting some more and going to another one and getting some more and then selling it? Unless you have a way of checking that, because right now in this state, we have people driving up here from Georgia buying high-powered drugs from pharmacies, skipping around from different ones and going back to their state and selling it. So I see some regulation issues here.
So you're saying we have a prescription drug problem?
Yes, we do.
Thank you for that. And this actually will be better than the prescription drugs that issue that we have now, because what will happen is basically those patients, once they apply to the Department of Health, are going to give up all their personal privacy rights. So this is better than the prescription drug monitoring as far as that goes. The other reason, the other question you had was about the pharmacies. Federal government won't allow because of the DEA and with their narcotics dispensary license. They can't do it. And
is there any idea how much this is going to cost?
The cost, yeah. And that's, you know, basically it should be a net negative or a positive for the state itself. The local, where it's going to come in to is at the local level if they decide to, you know, vote in an additional tax stat on top of their sales tax specifically for these centers. You know, basically, it shouldn't be any different than going to a pharmacy now, because the only people that should have it is if you have that card. So if you're, it's just like if you have Vicodin. If you have Vicodin in your car right now and you don't have a script for it, you're breaking the law. And that's the way this will be also.
What's the profit margin on one of these care centers?
That I can't answer yet.
23 other states.
Right.
Anybody testifying on any of these issues from other states about how this is working, or you probably got some?
I know there's several people here to testify in favor. I've been wanting gentlemen to give some informational purposes, but that's...
Thank you.
Representative Hicks.
To a part.
Go ahead.
Thank you kindly. If you can, please, just, I want to touch on a little bit in here. Section 195.222, it goes on, we're talking about bath salts and such again in there. I've received a few letters on that. Can you touch base on that and make sure that we're still making the K2 products, things like that, still illegal?
Do you have a page number?
Yeah, matter of fact, I do page 2. 195.22. Yeah, well, below that, I guess.
So. Yeah, the only thing we're...
Line item 11.
Right, the only thing we're doing in these sections, instead of using the key and everything, we're changing it to such person to make it gender neutral.
And I do, just to touch note, I do want to agree with you. A couple of letters, of course, I've received too, are claiming that this is going to be a cash cow for the rich, getting richer and things like that, but... Thank you for clearing up the part about the fees and things. As a franchise owner ourselves, my family, we understand how those work just like you do. And it's just typical for any business in the state to do business, and I can agree with them 100%. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Representative Condon.
To inquire, Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
One of the things I'm looking for in this bill is a very tightly defined set of ailments for which this will be prescribed. And it looks to me on page 9, starting around line 42 or 41, it defines pretty clearly the ailments for which this would be allowed to be prescribed. Could you speak just for a moment about how we came to that set of particular ailments?
Sure. Pretty much testing that and research that's been done to know that those specific ailments have seen a good response to this. And then some of the things that aren't in here are in the CBD oil bill that we passed last year. So some of the things you may not see specifically in this chapter, but they cross-reference over to the CBD oil.
Okay, and just to follow up on that, there also looks in subsection B there to be sort of a little bit of leeway then for a prescribing doctor based on particular symptoms
from those
that people, I guess, find the cannabis successful in treating.
Correct.
So we've narrowly defined particular ailments. We've also left it to the person's physician and the relationship between themselves and their doctor to determine when this is necessary. Is that correct?
For the symptoms of the ailment, correct.
Thank you for the bill, Representative Henson.
Further questions for the bill handler, Representative Pace?
Thank you. Report,
please. Go ahead.
Yes.
I just had one question, and it's in regards to the location as far as the licensing authority. And it had, in the summary, it has that there are certain areas, say for instance 1,000 feet from a school, and then it goes on to say, or a residential child care facility. Has there been any consideration given to a licensed daycare or child care facility as well to cover?
I believe that was our catch-all in there as far as any child care facility, but I'll...
Would you be open to looking?
Yeah, I'll make sure that, you know, that's tight language. The chairman and I have spoken about a couple of things to make sure that, you know, we want to make it tight so we don't affect those areas.
Well, I appreciate that because it's his residential, and I know that kind of
Right. Helps
out some of the others. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Further questions for the bill handler? Seeing none, I understand. Before we get started with testimony, can I get a show of hands of all those here to testify in favor of this legislation? And then all those against? And for informational purposes? Okay. Just a reminder for all the witnesses, when you come up to testify, if you could make sure and fill out a witness form so we have that information, and then leave it on the desk when you're done. Representative, I understand you've got a selection of witnesses to lead things off.
I believe there is a list.
Mr. Chairman, can I make a couple comments, please? I know we have a number of witnesses, and what I would ask, Mr. Chairman, let's keep our testimony, let's not be repetitive. State facts are fine. Please don't read to me, but more than one state of fact. I have no problem with that. Is that kosher? Thank you.
My name is Joni Miller. I'm with the Epilepsy Foundation of Missouri and Kansas, and I have just a very short statement. Not only are there over 300 different types of seizures that affect close to 200,000 people in the state of Missouri, but there are many other types of epilepsy syndromes, and these syndromes are extremely difficult to control, and increasing the percentage of THC within the CBD oil will give the much needed flexibility to help control very difficult control seizures. Children that have failed at least three medications are the ones that are in desperate need of this type of medication. And I hope that for the sake of these children in the state of Missouri that this is done. The synthetics that was mentioned earlier don't work because it doesn't have the combination of the CBD and THC.
Questions for the witness? Representative Hicks.
Too far, please.
Go ahead.
On page 8 there, we go back into the synthetic part of it. Page 8, line item 29. Are you going to be using synthetic parts?
My understanding is that it would be derived from the hybrid plant, not
okay,
synthetics.
So we won't be using synthetics because we know they're not natural, but it looks like it says in here, including its naturally occurring of synthetic, but those aren't natural.
And I would have to get back with you on that, I'm sorry.
It does plainly say right there, synthetic produced ingredients, but right before it says it's naturally occurring, but we know they're not natural, they're chemical. I just want to make sure that we're not opening a rat's nest on this one here. Things are going to start pouring out that we don't want to see. Just get back to me on that. I just want to make sure that, you know, we already have laws in place in certain areas. I don't want to see this hurt this bill at all. At all. I think it's a good bill.
Agreed.
And the only reason I bring that up again is I've had questions on that from constituents and other letters that probably aren't constituents of mine.
Further questions from the witness, Representative Rowden.
To inquire, Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
Thank you for your testimony. Just want to confirm something. Last year, you probably know, we passed the CBD oil bill through the body and into law. And so just to clarify what you're saying, basically this is another additional step that if what is outlined in the CBD oil bill didn't do the task that it was designed to do, then this is takes it further. It's another opportunity for pain management. Is that that's accurate?
Seizure control, correct.
Okay, so so there could be some overlap in what we did in the folks who could potentially be treated by what we did last year, as well as this. But this would just be basically an additional opportunity for pain management that maybe that CBD oil didn't do.
Correct.
Right.
It would increase the THC level that would allow the flexibility, the percentage, that would allow the flexibility in increasing the combination of the two for better seizure control for those that have very difficult epilepsy syndromes and things like that.
And there wouldn't be anything as far as parameters that were set by the CBD bill last year that would be in conflict with this?
I don't believe so.
Okay, thank you.
Further questions for the witness? Seeing none, thank you for your testimony. Further testimony in favor of the bill?
Good evening. My name is Brian Fox. I'm from Town and Country, Missouri. I'm here today to support the cannabis bill. I recently was awarded a dispensary license in Marion, Illinois. And a few comments to make about what I see us doing correctly and what Illinois needs to work on. One thing I noticed in our bill is a three-tier licensing process, which requires local government to approve these facilities after they've built and done all their work construction. After that point, it goes to the state for approval. I think we need to cut out one of those or have them work more in conjunction to have the best way to award these licenses. My process in Illinois was going to local government, telling them my purpose for being in their city, and then once getting zoning approval, I was good on the local level. And then to put together the application for the state was the next step. I think that we need to take some of this three-tier licensing out of the equation. Another thing, I want to answer your question earlier in regards to the fees and holding $500,000 in your account. I'm a father, I have three sons, and I don't have much money, but I want a dispensary in Illinois because I'm passionate, and I went out and I found people to help me and raise the money. So I don't think this is a rich man's game. I think this is people that are passionate, people that want to get into this industry and understand that the power that we can have here, it's not going to push people out. If you really want this, you can work for it. As far as the 30 dispensaries and the 30 cultivation licenses, Illinois currently has 60 allowed to the state. They did theirs by Senate district to try to accommodate all the population equally. I assume that will be somewhat of what we're looking at doing here. And I think that's important too, to make sure that we have people having access within proximity of their homes. I know caregivers can go and pick up the medication, but we need to have access for everyone throughout the state. And as far as the $500,000 also, the reason why in Illinois I'd have $400,000 in my bank account when I applied, it's not to show that I'm serious, that's part of it. What it really shows is that once I win my license, can I do the build out? Can I do the hiring? Do I have the money to do what it takes to open my dispensary? That's why they require that much money in your account, liquid assets. So that once we win that license, I can go, I have an 8,000 square foot facility that I have to do a tremendous amount of work to. So that's what more of the money is to show that you can, once you win that license, you can do the work you promised you're going to do.
Questions for the witness? Representative Hicks.
To the choir, please.
Go ahead.
I'll make this one brief, sir. Just a quick thing here. $25,000 application fee that is non-refundable, correct?
Yeah, that's for cultivation in Missouri.
What if we pay the $25,000, let's just say I want to start growing the stuff, I pay the $25,000, but my application is denied. That's a $25,000 loss right off the bat.
Yes, sir.
How are we going to regulate that to make sure that this $25,000 isn't just pocketed and people are being told no?
Well, I would hope, I don't know what the process is going to be in Missouri for deciding what applicants win licenses. So
there is a process in place in other states.
In Illinois, they had a process, they had a scoring system posted on their website that described each section of the scoring, whether it be security, distribution, tracking of the product, and all that stuff. But I didn't know who was actually judging that, who was scoring it. But I knew what was being scored, not who was scoring it, and how they viewed certain things.
That's understandable. I mean, I just don't want to see a cash cow created off of that either. A bunch of people putting applications in and they're being told no, but there's a bunch of money now sitting somewhere in someone's hands. I might want to look into that a little bit more, maybe a refund if you're denied.
Oh. I think
maybe a processing fee I can get they would keep, but I mean, that is a big chunk of money for somebody to give up. I mean, it could be a life savings for somebody for that matter. I mean, they could have what they need, liquid assets of $500,000 and the $25,000. They could have scraped, put everything together they can, and now they're out for $25,000 if their application is denied.
I understand. Or you could be creative and do what I did. I went out there and found people that have the funds and are passionate and do want to help and want to get involved. That's another way to go, though.
And then when my application's denied, those people are mad at me.
Yeah.
I would like to see it. Yeah, I think we should talk about that. If I could speak with you, representative, maybe on the side, we could talk about that one. Like I said, I like this bill. I'm sorry I keep finding little things here and there, but I just want to see this thing pass, honestly. But that's all I have. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Representative Zare.
Chair Quire, please.
Go ahead.
Sir, you mentioned that in your experience, you saw that the three levels are a little bit cumbersome, but you didn't mention why specifically. Can you go into that?
Well, I believe the bill states
local
that.
Local, state, and?
I believe the bill states that you have to get local approval first.
Okay.
And that requires doing building out your dispensary, building out your location, or just plans?
Plans.
Once you put all the money in and the plans in, get surveys and all this work, if the local government approves you, then you go to the state. If the state then denies you, that's where I kind of see an issue. I think that once you get through local approval, it can go to the state for approval, but not disapproval. I think that it should move on from that point. If you've shown that you've met all the criteria of the local government, then it should be passed on to the state for them to look over and agree to that licensing.
I see. Okay. All right. Thank you.
Representative Hanson?
Yeah, just to inquire real quick.
Right.
And I appreciate your comments because I was reading just when you started about the issue that Representative Zare brought up here. I don't see any need where we should have to do local municipality in that. Who are the experts in my county that's going to oversee this? And who are we going to have to hire in the county tax-wise to see whether this facility is built right or I've got the right everything? I agree with you 100%. I think that's got to come out of there. I think we need to go directly to the state and be applying for these licenses. And number two, on the $25,000, I would suggest we put that in escrow until everything's done. And if I don't get it, I get my $25,000 back out of escrow.
Further questions for the witness? Seeing none, thank you for the testimony. Further witnesses in favor?
I'm happy to have a chance to talk with you this evening. My name is Linda Pevnik. I'm a native Missourian. I'm a 29-year resident of an unincorporated section of St. Louis County. I'm a licensed clinical social worker here in Missouri, and I'm licensed to provide psychotherapy and diagnosis, and I've done so in private practice in the Creve Coeur area for over 30 years. My husband is here with me tonight. He's a biostatistician, retired from Washington University in St. Louis, Medical School Department of Biostatistics. We're here as parents. I'm here as a mom to tell you about our son, Michael, who's 28 and suffers from Crohn's disease, which is an autoimmune system disease that aggressively attacks one's own gastrointestinal system. It's a very little understood problem, and it's often hard to treat and can be disabling and even life-threatening. Our son came down with Crohn's disease 5 years ago when he was 23. And he suffers almost constant abdominal pain nausea. He vomits frequently, sometimes daily, and is so dizzy he rarely gets out of bed and only travels out of the house to doctor's appointments. Our son Michael had a lot of potential. He graduated four-year college with a dual degree in chemistry and physics and applied to and was accepted to a PhD program in applied physics, which he began but had to drop out of due to his illness. So now he lives at home with us. We're both 65 and we're his sole caretakers, and the illness that he has is not able to be treated by any of the medications that are available today. He's seen a number of doctors and they've thrown up their hands. Last doctor that I saw with him, I said, what do you do when someone has a debilitating disease like this? And he says that we do nothing right now because we don't know anything else we can do for him. And the doctor walked out of the room. So we continue to hope, but the situation is understandably breaking our hearts, my husband and myself, to see our son with so much potential, so very ill and so disabled. He's 6 foot tall and struggles to keep on about 140 pounds because of all the vomiting and nausea. Our son struggles with depression, as do my husband and myself, because of the situation. So we are excited about the possibility of this bill, 800, to allow medical cannabis. We've been reading numbers of scientific studies. My husband is a scientist with statistics, and we see that scientific studies show that the active ingredients in cannabis can reduce the pain and nausea in Crohn's disease, reduce the need for dangerous immune-suppressing medication and surgeries, reduce the effects of scar tissue caused by Crohn's, which scar tissue from Crohn's actually causes the same symptoms that Crohn's does. So even if you don't have an active case of Crohn's, after you have the scar tissue, you can continue to have the same symptoms. But there's nothing doctors can do about that. And obviously greatly increase the quality of life. In fact, the active ingredients in cannabinoids actually activate receptors in the gut lining, promoting it to actually heal inflamed tissue. And there's no other medication available that does that. So it actually can reverse Crohn's disease and in some cases even provide remission. So obviously other states have legalized cannabis for the treatment of Crohn's, and we have, even being longtime residents of Missouri, contemplated at our age, leaving our home and moving to a state like that, and this would obviously be great for us, so we wouldn't have to do that. We're hoping that that you will pass this bill, and we are hoping that the use of medical cannabis could help our son to become, again, a productive member of society.
Thank you for your testimony. Questions for the witness? Seeing none. Next witness in favor of the legislation.
This is a great honor. Thank you very much, Chairman and legislators. My name is Tom Mundell. I'm the past last year state commander for the Veterans of Foreign Wars, as well as the vice chairman for MAVO, the Missouri Association of Veteran Organizations. For the last 9-10 years, I've been involved in VFW. I've had a lot of people come to me for a lot of different reasons, and some of you in this room taught me this, and many people here in Jeff City and Washington, D.C. taught me that one thing that we have to do, regardless of how we feel personally about an issue, we must, if we feel passionate about it, and the facts are the facts, we should stand up and try to do the best that we can for those people that may need something that we're not really knowledgeable about. And one thing that I've done is, you know, you have to put education and experience and knowledge together and go out and really try to find out what the facts are about this issue. I had about 1 o'clock in the morning one night, I had a phone call from a lady. One of my passions were quadriplegics. triplegics and paraplegics. If you don't know what that is, for some in this room, that's people that has no legs and no arms. That's a quadriplegic. And a triplegic is someone with two arms and one leg, etc. Paraplegics is only with two, missing two. I had a mother call me and wanted me to meet her at 1 o'clock, I mean at 7 o'clock in the morning. She was gonna pick me up and take me somewhere. And this was a mother of a quadriplegic. And so I didn't know what the situation was, and she brought me down. And to preface this story, I will say that there was 19 of them, these very catastrophically injured, wounded veterans that was suffering terribly. I will say they were, all of a sudden, a few years ago, it was almost like a clock ticked, and they all were on the verge of suicide. And it was terrible. And no matter, and you can't go in and say, how are you doing today? Have a good day? Because they do not have a good day. They're not happy. They're never happy. And she brought all this up to me in her drive to where she was taking me. And she goes, you know how so-and-so was going to pass away? And remember this young lady. This young lady is a beautiful young blonde girl lady. And she has no legs and no arms. And she was on the verge of real bad suicide. And I promised her I would do anything for her, no matter what it was. And one of the things she asked me to do, just before the last time I saw her, was that she wanted me, when I came back the next time to visit her, after she saw her mom and her brother and sister, was she said, you see that little blue hose right there next to me? And I said, yes. And she said, I want you to hold that, I want you to come here and give me a kiss and squeeze that hose shut for 4 minutes and walk out and never come back. She knows, she said, I know if there's a real God out there, they'll give me a chance. A second chance is a whole woman. And nothing is going to change that. I want out. I want another chance. When this lady got me to this house and I walked in, there was probably 10 families. There were 7 families there representing that their young veterans that was debilitated, catastrophically injured. And I walked in and I took a look at her son, and for the first time, he's laughing, he's talking to some other people that was there and this, that, and the other thing, and I couldn't really believe it. And I walked over and she said, come on over, come on over. And we started talking, and this lady walked up, happened to be the mother of the daughter. I mean, that her daughter was the young lady that I had been seeing. And I can tell you, every single time, I had seen her 17 times, and I saw this young man 19 times. That's how big of an effect. Of course, it bothers them more than it does us, but it bothered me terribly trying to deal with this. And she suddenly came up and she hugged me and she said, Tom, you've got to save my daughter. And I looked at her, and then I looked at the other mother, and the other people started gathering around me. And she said, my son and my daughter, my son is going to go to prison. And she said, my daughter's going to go to prison. What's worse is I'm going to go to prison now. And I said, what is this all about? What's going on? And all of a sudden, I saw a brother of one of these people come in with a bag. And it was like the kind you put a respirator on, but not that kind. But it was just a plastic bag. And it was, I think they called it a vaporizer. They vaporized the marijuana, the medicinal, and just squeezed it and put the active ingredients, not the harsh whatever else is in it, and it really calmed him down instantly. She said she wanted me, the mother of the daughter said she wanted me to come see her daughter because her whole attitude's changed. And what all these veterans had in common, these families had in common, was the fact that he doesn't want to die anymore. She doesn't want to die anymore. It actually gave them some sort of psychological acceptance of their situation and reduced the pain. And the other thing is that he was on 98 pills a day. The young lady was on 53 pills a day. And the only medications they are taking now is one of them had a kidney transplant, Hillsborough rejection, and farther amputations. And they were able to get rid of the hydrocodone, oxycodone, and all that, and it just seemed to be, the smoking, the medicinal, seemed to assist. The Marinol, which is the synthetic, does not work. Did not work for them, and it hasn't worked on the cancer patients I've seen. And the primary issue with these people was that when they're scared to death. Now there's all kinds of anxieties there, saying, what are we going to do? We're going to go to jail. Even the parents are going to go to jail because they're in some cases actually giving their child marijuana because they want some peace of mind in their children. And I said, I don't know enough about this. I'm going to have to educate myself and get some knowledge. And that's exactly what I did. I spent many, many months, over a year now. I've gone to Colorado twice. I've gone to Washington State. I went to Washington, D.C. And the issues that some of you are saying that they're having in Colorado, I happened to talk to the governor of Colorado, and I sat in the committee for Sanjo Chui. He's the director of the Institute of Drug Study Policies in Washington, D.C. He was there along with quite a few other people. And it's overstated of all these people that's saying there's a lot of issues of drug problems and things like that in Colorado and Washington. They're not really seeing that in reality. That's what they're saying to me. That's the people that are really in the know. I also went to the VA, and I interviewed 37 people. And I hate to say it that all 37, I don't hate to say it, but I just want you to know that's who they were. Some of them were in Colorado, some in Washington, and every single one of them except for one was a veteran. And I asked them what they were doing it for, why they were doing it, and it came back to that they couldn't handle the medications they were on. And the medicinal marijuana seemed to help them considerably, and I said, I'm going to have to talk to a doctor now. And I went and talked to a VA doctor. He sat down with me for 35 minutes when he found out what I was there for. And I wasn't his patient, but he was very adamant about this. He goes, let me say something. He goes, did you know that man has made billions of pills? But there is not one single pill made on this earth that will not kill you. If you take enough of a pill, it will kill you. But he said that you can smoke marijuana, regardless of the percentage of it, all day long, every day, and it's gonna either make you hungry, make you a little bit tired, put you to sleep, make you happy, but it's certainly not gonna kill you. We're talking about something that was put on this earth that's natural, and it's not something that was man-made that's a synthetic. And I don't think there's any historic record I've been able to find of any death that's ever been caused by marijuana, medicinal marijuana. And I will close by saying that the veterans in the state, as well as I've talked to so many people that has Crohn's disease, has multiple sclerosis, muscular dystrophy, and especially the young children's parents that have the disorder, I don't want to call it fits, but what is it called? Seizures, I'm very sorry. Seizure disorders that only one person I've talked to was against because they were upset about Marinol, what it did to their daughter. But when they caught their brother, they didn't know what had happened. They had no idea what had happened, but somehow her brother had gotten that oil and had given it to their daughter, and she had gone, her seizures had decreased considerably. But when they introduced the smoke to her, which I know that that's a bad deal about a child and smoke, but I just want you to know what they said to me. I'm just giving you the facts that from the time it took about a week and a half to 2 weeks of it, but the child's gone 91 days without a seizure. And it's a miracle from God. And if you believe in God or if you don't, this is a natural thing on this earth. It's just like opium. Opium is a natural. It's oxycodone and all the derivatives of opium that messes everybody up. And it's some of the derivatives of tetrahydrocannabinol that messes everybody up. It's not the green itself. So I beg you to consider this. Use your knowledge. Educate yourselves. And put that all that wisdom that you all have. I know you all decided the right thing 99.9% of the time. And I know you will in this case, too. But thank you for your time and your efforts. And if you have any questions. Yes.
Questions for the witness, Representative Hicks.
To inquire, please.
Proceed.
There's one thing that I didn't hear you mention, sir, and I'm just curious because I know quite a few veterans. PTSD.
Yes, sir. Put me on the spot there.
Well,
and I appreciate that, I do. I wasn't going to say anything. If somebody asked me, I'm going to bring it up. So thank you. Okay, post-traumatic stress disorder. I will say that I have not met one veteran, and I have not met one individual that has, it's not only veterans that have post-traumatic stress disorder, there's a lot of people in this room that's not veterans, that they got post-traumatic stress disorder from a lot of different issues in their life. But they all have a very distinct opinion that marijuana does reduce the effects of post-traumatic stress disorder unbelievably. And for someone that's been shot down 11 times, spent 17 months in a hospital, fought from Vietnam, 3 tours in Nam, 4 years in Iran, 2 years in Iraq, 17 months in Afghanistan, Pakistan, I'll be the last one on this earth to say I don't have a little bit of PTSD, but at least I have emotions now. And that's something I didn't have when I was fighting, when I was a warrior. Because I just, you just can't do what I did for a living and really have emotions and do your job right. You just got to do it and deal with it later. But, okay, I'm going to do it. I had my daughter's mother. My daughter's mother found me out in the garden one night at 3 o'clock in the morning. And I guess I was going through some kind of stupid head trip that I've always tried to hide from everybody. And I thought she was putting a cigarette in my mouth. And I pushed her away and I said, get that out of my face. And she goes, Tom, you're dying. Something's going wrong. You need to relax. Please, just try this. And I have to admit, I did. And I didn't notice that I kept trying it with her that night. They're sitting in that garden. And for the first time in a long time, I started doing what I'm doing right now. I got emotional. I started caring, not only for others, but myself. I started thinking about things. And it really relaxed me. And at that time, I will admit to you all here right now, I was on 71 pills a day. I was taking 41 in the morning and 30 at night. And I take 3 now. I'm not going to admit to anything else. And I can't because you all know Dewey Reen and some of the others that I have to deal with every day. And please don't come. But, and the governor. So see, I've really come out of the closet on this one. So when I say that I'm a little, you know, I've been scared coming to these testifying here for years, but I've never been uncomfortable. But this time, I was really uncomfortable coming up here to this chair. But I felt that I needed to step up and be a man, and be a leader, and do after my due diligence. I did not do this on the spur of the moment. You know, I just didn't jump up here and do this. I did my homework. I went over this nation on my own penny, and I talked to the people that I thought I needed to talk to and get to the basis of this situation. And I came to the conclusion that I needed to be sitting in this chair saying these words right now to a group of people right now that I know you want to know what the facts are. And as far as the facts that I see them, medicinal marijuana, which I don't know how much education, how much knowledge you've all gained of why it became illegal to begin with, and what the situation was way back then in the 1900s, early 1900s. Everybody thinks it was during the Nixon administration, but sorry to say, it was back in the early 1900s. It was made illegal for reasons that I'm not even going to bring up right now, but it had nothing to do with health, okay? It's a natural product that should be considered to be brought out. And once again, I don't think it would hurt anybody in this room, okay? Probably put a little smile on some people's faces and never smile. Okay, and we all need that. So, I didn't mean to go ramble on. I hope I answered your question, but PTSD, I have to say from my own point of view, which is to me a big deal, can't believe I actually was honest here and told you the way it was for me.
I thank you for your honesty, and I think every member on this committee does, sir. We also thank you for your tremendous service to this country and the individuals that are sitting in this room today.
It's not a problem.
You fought so that we can do this process we're doing now.
That's why I'm here.
I thank you, sir.
This is democracy.
And thank you for everything you do for our veterans, and that's why I wanted to bring that up.
Thank you very much. Are there any other questions over the any information I've covered?
Representative Faber. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One of the things that you brought up, and I mentioned this with Representative Henson when he opened the bill, some of the things that you're talking about, I'm curious how you feel about the no personal grow component of this.
Well, you're really trying to stick it to me on this today.
Well, I mean, it's a general conversation. I mean, if people are, if there's a stigma or that they're uncomfortable or whatever,
I can understand his point of view. And I know why it's there like that. We're trying to get this passed. We want to get a bill in here and get things going so that we can help these people that really do need it. And if that's the way the bill has to be written to get it to go through, so be it. Things can be altered later. That's why they have changes. But I agree with you with if a person does have the card, and I spend a lot of time in Colorado and Washington State talking to these people and everything. They do give the people that have license the ability to grow 6 to 12 plants or something like that. And you're not going to, the concern of them going out and selling the product is ridiculous. And the reason being, they're doing it already. I mean, what are you going to stop? It's already done. They're already doing it. And they were doing it before. This is going to legitimize and legalize the situation. And if somebody's got a card and they're growing a few plants, there's laws in place right now. If they go out and sell to somebody and get busted, their butt goes to jail, okay? And those the laws are already in place. And I think that it would not hurt to allow that individual to grow 6 to 12 plants in my own, but that's my own personal opinion. I don't have anything to go on other than what I've heard. What I've found is that most people that are ill, that they when they're growing it for ease of mind to do something that they feel that they enjoy doing it. It's like planting a garden.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Further questions for the witness? Seeing none, thank you for your testimony. We get that. Appreciate it.
God bless you all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Further testimony in favor?
Chairman, members of the committee, my name is Kina Iman, and on behalf of the Governmental Affairs Committee and our board at Missouri Nurses Association and the American Nurses Association, we are in support of the Missouri Compassionate Care Act.
Questions for the witness? Seeing none, thank you for the testimony. Further witnesses in favor?
My name is Connie Gregory, or Connie Boudreau, sorry. I am 56 years old. Forgive me, public speaking is something I've avoided for the last 56 years. But this is one subject I will come out, I will humiliate myself, I will talk to anybody about. First, I want to thank Representative Henson for sponsoring the bill and Chairman Hart and Vice Chair Cross and the committee as a whole for taking, time for this hearing. The issue of medical cannabis is of paramount importance to me as I suffer from severe spinal stenosis, diabetic neuropathy, which means most of the time I do not feel my feet when I walk. I have damage caused by pharmaceutical medications, and mind you, I spent 25 years in healthcare. Specifically, Tylenol number 3 was overgiven to me for 2 years. I lived in Canada for 15 years up until a year ago. I now have permanent ringing in my ears where the volume changes continually. I have I have liver damage. I have fatty liver. I basically have 4 inches on my right side that just shouldn't be there and will never go away. And this is from legal narcotics. This is an issue for many Missourians. We have good, hardworking people leaving Missouri on a daily basis due to the fact that they or a family member needs cannabis. Simply put, this must end. Missouri, not only is a person using cannabis therapy at risk of criminal convictions, so are their families. And I knew I had 23 states, or at the time I had 22 states to choose from when I moved back, but my family is here and that's why I am here. I came back in January of 2014. I spent 3 years as a medical cannabis patient in Canada. It is a federally run program. They're on a parliamentary system, but it's a federal run program. After 2 days of cannabis therapy, I was able to drop 6 narcotic pain medications and nerve medications. I went from being bedridden, and I had a $20,000 wheelchair delivered. I left the wheelchair when I came home and saved my insurance company $20,000. I went from being bedridden to being able to go out and live the life that I deserve. I considered states where it is already legal before I made the move, but Missouri is my home. It is where my family lives, so I choose to come home knowing it would be a challenge to bring medical cannabis to Missouri. I know that with your help, we can do this and do what is in the best interest of the patients in Missouri. While I agree with passing medical cannabis bill, I think there are improvements that we can make on this proposal. The reality is that a majority of cannabis therapy patients are disabled and on very limited incomes. I stress very limited incomes. Imagine being in such a situation and forced regularly to travel 50 to 100 miles to access medicine you need. But that is exactly the situation many patients will face. If the number of dispensaries is severely limited and home cultivation is prohibited. This will place unbearable burdens on those in society who need this therapy the most and be forced to turn or continue to use the black market, which I think is what, no matter what state you're in, is what we're all trying to get away from. I am from Southern California, so I know that's what they want to get away from. Thank you for your time and interest in this subject. I very much appreciate you having this hearing. But as I said, home cultivation, in my opinion, is of utmost importance. I understand this is a big change for Missouri. I really do. But when you don't allow home cultivation and you're going to have these 30 dispensaries in Missouri, I live a mile and a half outside the city limits, but I cannot get a bus. I cannot get the accessible transportation because I'm off of the bus route. So basically, I would have to spend $30 to $40 to take a cab into Springfield, go to the dispensary, and another $30 or $40 to come home. And when patients are faced with issues like that, by the time you add to the cost of what they're going to be paying, it's not benefiting those who are probably going to need it the most. And again, I do want to thank you guys for having this hearing. I waited a year for this. And again, thank you for the CBD oil bill last year. And that's it. I hope I didn't make too much of a full on sale.
Thank you, Cassidy. Real briefly, if you had to choose between this bill as it stands today or no change, would you support this bill even without a home grow portion?
I think I've reached a point to where I swore I would never say this. I'm never one to settle. But just for the sake of having one, I think in the back of my head I would. Although it would pretty much, the two big things, well, there was the financial thing and the homegrown thing, but financial is, I'll leave that for the expert over there. But I know about the home cultivation in Canada, for instance. They changed a lot of their regulations last year because this is all government run. One of the changes they did away with was home cultivation. Mind you, it was less than 30 days later, the Canadian government found themselves in federal court. There is now an injunction. The people who held licenses to cultivate can continue to cultivate until the trial, which starts next week. And I can just about, and mind you, Canada does not have a medical cannabis program because Canada wants one. Canada has one because the people of Canada went to court and sued for the right to choose and make their own medical decisions. They talk about drug overdoses from oxycodone and what have you. But yet, you know, other maybe gaining too much weight, you know, that's the only issue I've ever had with using medical cannabis. And the thing with cannabis is you get into different strains. Not all of it makes you sleep, not all of it makes you eat. And not all of it makes, it just, there are different strains. They're kind of, I guess you could say, tailored to what it is you're after, whether it be pain relief, appetite increase, or energy, any of that. So, yeah, I think in a way I would back it regardless, as long as I knew we could fight or try to get changes made.
Further questions for the witness? Seeing none, thank you for your testimony.
Thank you.
Next witness testifying
in favor. Hello, my name is John Payne. I'm the executive director of Show Me Cannabis. I'd like to thank Representative Henson, Chairman Haar, and the committee for hearing this bill today. We've already heard from several patients and family members whose lives could be improved with legal access to medical cannabis. However, for every potential patient who has spent the time and resources to be here this evening, there are thousands of others who cannot make it because of physical or financial limitations, or would not because of the stigma that still surrounds this issue for many people. Our organization represents nearly 100,000 Missourians, and every day I receive testimonials from people who must choose between living in debilitating pain or in constant fear of arrest and imprisonment for using the medicine that they have found to be most effective. This is not the mark of a free or civilized society. Furthermore, medical cannabis could potentially bestow tremendous public health benefits to the entire state. This past August, the Journal of the American Medical Association published an article showing an association between states with medical cannabis laws and lower opioid overdose death rates. And I think we've heard that from many of the witnesses. People are using medical cannabis to replace many of their other prescriptions, and that's starting to show up in the data. So, in fact, the states that have legal medical cannabis laws have nearly 25% fewer opioid overdose per capita than states without such laws. So cannabis can provide a far less habit-forming and non-lethal painkiller than the narcotics that we are currently prescribing legally. That said, I am concerned that some provisions in this bill will limit the benefits of a medical cannabis system, specifically the sharp limit on the number of dispensaries at 60 and the substantial barriers to entry presented by the $25,000 application fee and $500,000 asset requirement. that will limit competition and prevent many patients from accessing their medicine and increase prices for those who do so. I think we can learn a lot from the best practices that have been established in some of the 23 other states that have implemented medical cannabis programs. And you actually all should have the financial information, the packet that I put out from the Marijuana Policy Project that has all the financial information from every state that has a medical cannabis system. I'll just provide one example in my testimony, which is Arizona. They have a similar population, similar right-leaning political culture as Missouri. As of late 2013, they have 98 dispensaries that have been approved to operate in Arizona, and they each paid a $5,000 application fee with a $1,000 renewal. The state requires dispensaries to show $150,000 in startup capital to be approved for a license, which is less than a third of what is required by this bill. Missourians rightly value a market economy driven by competition. We know that is what produces the best value for consumers. So as we consider creating a new market for some of our most vulnerable citizens, who can ill afford limited options and high prices, we must keep those lessons of economics in mind. Thank you.
Questions for the witness? Seeing none, thank you for your testimony. Further witnesses in favor?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Representative Hart, thank you, other representatives of the committee. Thank you very much to Representative Henson. My name is Montel Williams. I am not currently a Missouri state resident, but I've been working very diligently. I've been for months and associated with the state for years because one of my closest friends in life lives here. As a matter of fact, I was the best man at his wedding, so I spent a lot of time in and out of Missouri. I literally am here before you because this friend reached out to me a couple weeks ago. We've been working on multiple different initiatives together, which are business initiatives, and I happened to call him about one of those concerns one morning, and in his office was a group of gentlemen that were representatives of the Missourians for Compassionate Care. And when my friend asked me if I would speak to them because they were working on an initiative in the state to finally put in place a legitimate real medical marijuana law and possibly set an example for the rest of the country to look at, I said, I'm aboard. So the Missourians for Compassionate Care reached out to me in a letter and asked me formally to come down and ask if I would participate in their efforts to make people understand the issue that is before you today. We're talking about a bill here that was put together to provide an opportunity for doctors to have a relationship with their patients that is unlike any other relationship that a doctor has with a patient anywhere else in this country today. And to do so with a medication that is no longer a question. I think one of the things that we really have to do, and part of the reason why I wanted to be here today and kind of get an opportunity to speak, was because there are so many misconceptions and so much misinformation that is out there that clouds the conversation that I thought that maybe I can give us a starting point by talking to you today. I've listened to several of the people who have come before you and spoken and listened to several of your questions that you asked. I'd like to be able to, in a minute, maybe talk about some of those questions specifically, give you a couple answers that may help you. But I'd also like to maybe just talk to you a little bit about my journey and why we're here. Look behind me, there's a lot of Missourians here in this room. And they're all here because they heard that there was an issue on the table that wasn't about whether or not we do something right or wrong. We do something in the state of Missouri that's called compassion. And that is provide a medication to patients that now the world recognizes unequivocally works for not just one or two or three. I've heard the questions asked before. We're going to have a concise list of the number of diseases and maladies that this may be used for. But I'd like to bring the first piece of information to the committee's attention is the fact that in the last 20 years, the United States government has issued no less than 20 patents on medical marijuana. Those patents you can all find yourself if you were to go up online and take a look. Those patents range from diseases, and I'll read a few of them to you just so you can understand. The question was asked earlier, which illnesses do we capture with this? As far back as 1980, the United States government issued a patent on THC. And back then, it was because of the possibility of it working for ocular and for things like glaucoma. Over the course of the next 20 years, those patents increase to include everything from the very last one issued. But just so you understand, the patent was issued, methods of treating autoimmune hepatitis are provided, and the methods are including cannabis oil and other extracts. Patent before that issued talks about the fact that marijuana has been used, cannabinoids can be used for preventing diabetes. Cannabinoids can be used for everything from neurological degenerative disease. And it's not just what we've heard people up here, and I know last year, 2 years ago, this committee worked very hard to pass the CBD law, and there's been a television special out, and so all of a sudden, the entire country has become pharmaceutical experts and become biological experts, and so people know whether or not, you know, you should have marijuana that has THC, what's the percentage of THC, should it be CBD, should it be CBN1, CBN2, See, I can start throwing out letters and names because we're going to find out that the marijuana plant has close to and well over 160 cannabinoids, and we're still trying to figure out what they all do. But what we now know for a fact in the two patents that were issued to our federal government, I'm not sure if we understand that, but the United States government owns the patent on THC and CBD. I saw that look of concern over there. Yes, sir. The United States government owns the patent on CBD and THC, and in the last 2 years have started issuing licenses for their commercialization on a national level. The United States government has also, for now over 30 years, dispensed marijuana through a program at the University of Mississippi every single month for the last 37 years. The University of Mississippi has dispensed and sent a canister of marijuana out to starting with 21 patients and now down to 3 because they've allowed the other, all of them have died out. No one else could be added to the register. Currently, this month, 3 canisters of over 500 marijuana cigarettes will go out that have been grown by the United States government to patients in this country to sell melodies that they have. Now, we're debating here whether or not we should or should not. I would tell you that the only debate should be is whether or not we take the patient off the battlefield. While we argue and argue and argue, more and more people who could be helped by this medication are suffering. I want to take you back for a second on a little journey that I was on myself personally. I know a lot of you know much about me. They know me only as a talk show host. But I graduated from high school, entered the Marine Corps, the United States Marine Corps, back in 1974. I'm a National Defense wearing Vietnam vet. I entered service, 2 years in the Marine Corps, enlisted, and being meritoriously promoted 3 times. I entered the United States Naval Academy, where I graduated in 1980 with a degree in General Engineering, a minor in International Security Affairs. I went on to the Defense Life Institute and got a degree in Russian. I got a degree from the National Cryptologic School. And I served my time as an active duty special intelligence officer, cryptologic officer, direct support cryptologic officer. I have over 600 days on the water, 300 days under the water. I was in every single hotspot that this country had until I came off active duty. But what happened to me right before I graduated from the Naval Academy in 1980, unfortunately, we don't know the exact cause, but I had my first bout of MS right before I graduated. Blind in my left eye, held me up for a minute. They considered NPQ, not physically qualified, and then I had to go ahead and change services from Marine Corps to the Navy Commission. That episode that happened, that first bout, was never diagnosed. I went the next 20 years of my life being misdiagnosed, having MS, being partially blind in one eye, and I served for lack of duty. Every year, every other year, I'd have an anomaly, a big anomaly, you know, something would happen, my back would hurt, my leg would hurt.
something would throw me a little bit, but I always thought it was because of my lifestyle. I was a big weightlifter. I was also, you know, one of those Neanderthals who thought jumping out of airplanes and trees and anything else was good, so I did as much as I could. And then I got off active duty. I remember right before I came off active duty, I went to see a doctor, and back then I was weighing about 220 pounds. I was a weightlifter, doing a lot of crazy things. And the doctor looked at me and said, you know, it's really strange what's going on with that left arm of yours. And so I looked at the MRI, and anybody ever said anything to you about MS? Anybody in your family ever had this disease? I said, nah, what are you talking about? Move on. So I came back to duty. And for the next 15 years, I'm going back and forth to a doctor almost every 5 or 6 months. Once a year, something's wrong. I got this pain in my foot, I got pain in my side, I got pain in my face. We'll come and we'll go. Then, 1999, I literally, I'll tell you a little funny story. Do you remember the television show Touched by an Angel? Remember that? Della Reese, right? Rolla Downey. I was scheduled to play a guest starring role in that show. And back then, I was the only character that played on that show that at the end of it, Angel didn't save. Matter of fact, they let me burn and die. You know, this character that was Jimmy Jones, and I had this whole thing where, you know, I had a cult, and I was going to burn all the people in my cult. Well, as I flew out there, this was a Friday morning, I'll never forget this night. I'd been working out really hard, got on a plane that Friday morning to fly out to arrive in Utah to be fitted for my wardrobe at 4:30 in the afternoon. My first scene was Monday morning. I got in an airplane, my feet went on fire, and it now got out. I sit here and my feet burn. My feet burn so bad that that weekend I had to go to the doctor because I had a scene to play that Monday morning. And the doctor saw me over the weekend, couldn't figure out what was going on. By Monday morning, he looked in the face and said, I think you have an MS. And the pain was getting worse. And I had to go over because I was under a contract to go play the scenes that I was contracted to play. You go look that episode up, you'll notice that in this episode, I'm crying a couple times. And the director, all the other actors were amazed at how I could just cry at the drop of a dime. But it was because the second I let my brain feel this, this it does to me. Now, from 1981, 1999, 2000, to about 2002, I went through the gamut of every drug that doctors could prescribe. Tylenol, Oxycontin, morphine, I took Vicodin, I took Percocet, I took Ultracet, I could Vicodin. We have, you know, part of the reason why we have so many of them, and this is something I'm going to come back to in a second, we have so many prescription medications because the pharmaceuticals industry understands that they work for less than 30% of us. When they apply and they submit for FDA approval, 30% gets you FDA approval. That's the reason why you know, and some of you know, that you go to the doctor, the Vicodin makes your stomach upset, so they give you a Percocet. Percocet makes your stomach upset, they give you an Ultracet. That's so strong enough to give you an Oxycontin. We chase this. Why? Because it, none of it, all of it works for everyone. So I found out very quickly that after I got to 9 Vicodin every 4 hours, started doing 3 to 4, 5 Oxycontin every 4 hours, started shopping myself. And, you know, let's just face it, I am Montel Williams. So I can call a doctor and say, up. I can call another doctor and say, up. I can call another doctor and say, up. And the next thing you know, I got 120 morphine or oxycodone in my medicine cabinet. And believe me, 9 an hour or 4 hours wasn't helping. It's a point where it can't dull the pain. And it also gets to a point where you want to quit. I wrote about it twice. I'm not proud of it. I tried to take my life 2 times because the pain was so severe. I wanted to see a doctor. one of the top doctors in this country, looked me dead in the face and said, look, I'm not going to tell you, I won't say I told you, I'm not going to put it in writing, but I think you ought to go try some cannabis, because I'm not writing you another prescription. Okay? Easy access. I found it. No problem. Within 3 days, I literally, one, had one of those come to you-know-what with myself, of the fact of how ignorant I was for having taken so much of the prescription medication. Because by about the 8th day, I was not taking any of that at all. By about the 20th day, I was consuming cannabis all day. By about the 60th day, I was consuming cannabis about twice a day. Why? Because when I figured it out and worked with the doctors and I understood what was going on and I got my body to the saturation point that it needed to be, now my use of cannabis has come down, and I still use it now. But it's coming down because its effect on me has been almost analgesic. It has helped to reduce the pain in my body. I'm working on multiple things to help fight my MS. And I'm telling you, I'm fighting a really good fight. But just like all the wars that we've lost so far, we've lost because we have not gone to battle with the right tools in our arsenal, the right weapons in our quiver. Medical marijuana is not going to work for everybody. But there are those of us that it does work for, that I have to ask you, how dare you deny someone the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness? Because without it, I don't have that. Now, there are questions. How do we do it? Why do you have a $25,000 application fee? Because if you look at the other 23 states in the District of Columbia, 12 of which I have testified personally before, legislation for, I'm the first person in this country on with a company that received a license to grow cannabis in the nation's capital. And if you remember, the nation's capital laws are all sanctioned by our Congress and our Senate, therefore it had to be passed, so I would be the first person in the country to receive a license by the Congress and the Senate to grow marijuana in the nation's capital. I walked away from that. And why? I walked away from that company because, and the same reason why I didn't sit up here and I don't sit beside those who are for full recreational use. I'm saying to you right now, I could care less about anybody who wants to get high. Your problem, not mine. I'm only concerned about people who need to have relief with medication. The bill that you have before you is one of the most comprehensive bills that's been written. There's been attention paid to making sure that this works with patients. Yes, does it have a couple of issues? Yeah. But can they be fixed? Yes. I want to address something I feel very strongly about. I'm going to have some argument from probably people that are in this room. Not one of you up there goes to Duane Reade, CVS, or any pharmacy in this town, and walks in, sticks your hand into a jar, and picks the pill you put in your container. Not one of you grows opium in your backyard and figured out how to extract its active ingredients and powders your own pill. Our federal government stopped back in 1900 Americans from using what is considered one of the most efficacious drugs ever known to man. It's the only one that's not on the schedule. It's the only drug that right now any child in this state above the age of 9 can walk into any store in this state and purchase. And when they go home, if mom and dad aren't there, and they take a half bottle of it, they will be dead on your living room floor. It's not controlled. It's not on a schedule. And back in 1900, the federal government was smart enough to say, I don't think you as normal people should be going out of your backyard, picking this plant, boiling it, and drinking yourself. Because we had a lot of people wind up on their kitchen's dead. What is the drug I'm talking about? It's aspirin. It's from the willow tree. A lot of willow trees in the state. You don't want people walking out back, scraping off bark, boiling it, and drinking it. Might be my right. I could get it quicker. But if we're going to talk about medical marijuana, way you guys are thinking about doing it. You have an example right now to not be the show me state, but to show the rest of the states how to do this correctly. And you need to implement a medical marijuana law that's real. And I'm sorry, I don't know of too many people who grow their own individual medicine. We can teach people that there's a difference in the weed that's grown in some of these states that are coming here to talk to you about. I have a compassionate caregiver in three states. They are my personal growers. Why? Because some of what's on the street in Colorado, some of what's on the street of Washington State, some of what's on the street in Washington, D.C., some on the street in Arizona. I consume right now, it could give me a seizure because it's extracting a process with chemicals that I don't need to have in my body. You have the ability to lead in this. And you have so many people who've worked so hard to make sure that you take that leadership position. I would beg you to do so. The bill is set up the way it is to help you do exactly that. There was one question that came up a little earlier that I could not go without answering. Right now, currently in the state of Missouri, 50% of this state suffers from at least one chronic illness. 50%. By the year 2000, you will be 60 to 65% single chronic illness, and 80% of them will have two. Currently, state of Missouri, 7 out of 10 deaths are attributed to chronic illness. 7 out of 10. Now, out of those people with chronic illness, I'm going to tell you, not all of them could use medical cannabis. But every one of them should have a right to have a doctor prescribe it for them if it's possible. I'll leave you one more thought. This last year, my second oldest daughter went through, well, last year and a half, went through hell and back. She suffered from lymphoma. And unfortunately, in this country right now, for young girls ages 18 to 28, one of the fastest growing cancers that we have. She got it once. 7 months later, the doctors told her she was cured. She went home, we all went, ooh. 4 months later, came back with a vengeance. The doctor, one of the best doctors in this world. Doctor said to my daughter, I'm going to put you on this regimen. Now, as a parent, had he explained to me what that regimen was? And I'll tell you what it was. He said, there are going to have some difficulties. It's going to affect your skin. It could have a little effect in your esophagus and in your throat. But you'll get through this and you'll be okay. And then I watched my child's skin fall off. Then I watched my child throw up the lining of her esophagus. If you had given me the right as a parent to step in between my daughter and her doctor and say, I know what's better for her. Don't give her that medication. You're going to make her throw up her esophagus. How dare you? Don't do that. I know better than you, Mr. Doctor. Had I done that and you gave me the right to do that, my daughter would be dead today. The fact that I shut my mouth and let that doctor and my daughter have the relationship they were supposed to have and make the decision for her treatment, my daughter's alive. We don't question that when it comes to chemotherapy. Any other drug that any other doctor would put in the child. And now all of a sudden we're experts when it comes to cannabinoids. I want to ask you, please. You have the ability to do it. Take the patients off the battlefield. Get us off this battlefield. Authorize medical marijuana. You have a strict enough law here. You have enough people in this state that understand that you want to do it right. I'm here to help you do it right. And I'll stand by you every step of the way. Thank you.
Questions for the witness? Seeing none, thank you very much for your testimony. Can I get a show of hands of how many more people remain to speak in favor? Okay, we've been going about 2 hours. Mike, we'll try not to be repetitive. Thank you.
Two handouts. Thank you, sir.
Representative Haar, I'm impressed that you're my state representative. Thank you, sir. I'll vote for you next time, I promise. James Owen was a supporter of my Guatemala project. I'm very impressed. Thank you for this opportunity. I'm Gil Mobley from Representative Haar's district, Springfield, Missouri, and I've practiced medicine in 30 years for it. In Springfield, as an emergency trauma physician, I run a private emergency center that does a large market share of the workers' comp for the entire region. And on the West Coast, I've become a medical cannabis expert over the past decade, having practiced in Washington State, and I've authorized many very sick medical cannabis patients, and got the reputation of doing the most medically defensible authorizations in the state. Last year, I was asked to testify a half dozen times in Colorado, Washington State, and even in these hallowed halls, as not only a staunch advocate for medical cannabis, but for full legalization as well. Let me first thank the representatives for tackling this bill. It's sorely needed by some of the sickest patients in the state, because the time has come, as you've heard, that modern medicine can no longer deny the medical utility of cannabis. It cures seizures, anticonvulsants can't touch, it's a miracle drug in MS, and interrupts the same pathway that the powerful drug gabapentin does, and the identical interrupters of anti-cancer drugs now under development, believe it or not. But I'm against this bill unless you correct some fatal flaws. And please, these are things you haven't heard yet, so it's new information. Despite medical...
Are you testifying in favor or in opposition?
Okay. In favor, but with caveats to correct to make it better, sir.
Okay.
Yes. The first one would be, despite medical and recreational cannabis being around for some time, there's still no state that is adequately testing their product for all the necessary contaminants. Medical users must be concerned about disease-causing molds, pesticides, fungicides, spider mites, rodents, and heavy metals, and many users are already sick with compromised immune systems, can't handle these things. Washington State is leading the industry, and they still haven't figured out how to test for pesticides, and there's 2,200 that they're using. The article is there that points out the significance. Also, released just this week is a picture I provided with you of mold growing on petri dishes that is from Colorado-tested cannabis. My point is, the technology is expensive and labor-intensive and simply cannot be done in a private setting given the current funding structures. Colorado would have figured it out, and Washington would have figured it out over the last 15 years. So if Missouri is going to put their stamp of approval on cannabis, you need to do what no other state has yet been able to do, and that's to assure adequate testing is done without millions of dollars being spent. And it's going to take millions, that's why the other states aren't doing it. It's not going to be done, and you can't require it. In my assessment, there's only one way to assure patients have their medicine free of contaminants. Allow them to grow their own. Most of my patients in Washington State are fastidious horticulturalists. They know what's in their plants, and they know what's not. They know what's in their medicine, and they know what's not. In my handouts, I've showed you what you have. Please take a look at that. If you're thinking our cannabis is going to be tested, is going to be safe, wrong. It's not doable. Just look at the other states. My last comment has to do with two very brief objections I have. I'm against the bill that does not have provisions for education, because prevention and treatment will need to be addressed, such as dependency and addiction. If Missouri legalizes medical cannabis, the kids are going to hear that it's good, that it's medicine, there's no problems with it. Any medical cannabis bill, whether medicinal or recreational, must have a sizable portion of revenues devoted to prevention. Marijuana is devastating to the young mind under 21 years old. Any program introducing this product to normalcy must be coupled with a robust public education campaign so that public, especially the kids, get the whole picture, and this bill does not have that. That's the second fatal flaw. And the third one, you may not agree with me, but ladies and gentlemen, I'm the only doctor you're going to hear from tonight, and I'm well studied in this, and medical cannabis is safer than alcohol. It is safer than alcohol. And I think that full legalization is more important than the patients having a medicine. And that's hard for me to say because I have several hundred very sick patients that have been on Washington State. But when a state allows medical cannabis to flourish, all the state's stakeholders become against full legalization. And you have this big lobby. It stopped legalization in Washington State almost. It stopped it in Colorado. It stopped it in Oregon. And personally, I think drug policy reform means cannabis legalization. So all I know is that I was chairperson for the PAC on stopping 502 because of some lack of education and the DUI provisions. And I was skunk at the garden party. But the dispensary owners were steadfast against legalization because it was interrupting their turf. So when a state look like Missouri looks at both the rationale for reforming our marijuana laws, which are badly needed, and the dire need for patients to have access to their medicine. And if they choose the latter, medicine first, it's one step forward but two steps back on our way to full legalization. I would strongly encourage you to look at the Colorado model. You look at full legalization for adults, strict penalties for education, and also a special dispensation for patients. Thank you for your time, and my hat's off to your honorable service to the public. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. Questions to the witness? Representative Bondi.
To inquire briefly, Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
Is this the picture about which you spoke with the mold?
Yes, sir. This is
from a little about the origins of this.
Yes, sir. This picture came from Denver 7 News. It was released last week on February 11th, week before last, with state regulated and tested cannabis. This is an example of what you get when you can't validate and verify the temperature and humidity of cannabis as it works its way through the system. This isn't going to happen in home grows, ladies and gentlemen.
To follow up then, sir, if this is in a controlled medical environment, what's to stop this from happening with a patient that may or may not know what they're doing growing this stuff?
Patients need to have access to testing as well, but for the most part, this stuff is, molds are easy to see, but what isn't are the pesticides. The molds aren't necessarily going to kill somebody unless they have AIDS, which a bread mold can kill you. But the pesticides are widely used and no one's testing for them, and they have dire consequences. That's what's going to be used in the wholesale market widely, because one mite infestation can wipe out $500,000. If you believe me, with $500,000 crops in the state, they're going to use anything, everything, and we're not able to test for it. And somebody growing their own is not going to use that poisonous pesticide.
Okay, so you're more concerned, though, about the pesticides than you are about the mold. Am I correct on that?
Well, the mold is a problem as it works its way through the system. And then the pesticides, the heavy metals, and especially the solvents. The BHO, the butane honey mixture where they infuse, use the extracts, that has lots of solvents, highly poisonous. They need to be tested as well. And we're seeing lots of stuff being kicked out of Washington and Colorado because of it.
If you'll indulge me for just a few more questions, Mr. Chairman, do you support the full legalization of marijuana?
For adults, I say regulate tax like alcohol. Full legalization, it is safer than alcohol. You guys, you're representative, but you need to lead. And you need to understand that medical and cannabis in general, is safer than alcohol. Two wrongs don't make a right. I can't advocate cannabis before going into the workplace, nor alcohol. For Christ's sake, it is safer, and you've got to lead and educate. That's one reason why I'm here today.
Dr. Motley.
Yes, sir.
Please don't swear here.
I'm sorry.
That's answered all my questions. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Representative Hicks.
Sir, if I could inquire, please. I just want to clear the picture up. Okay. I want to make sure that we're on the same page here. This picture is of something that would be given to a patient, or
this picture is
something that was laying around on the desk after they were done testing it.
No, sir. No, sir. This was very carefully procured under a chain of custody in sterile environments and grown in a petri dish in a state sanctified lab, sir.
What was grown? The mold or?
The mold out of cannabis product, yes, sir. A cannabis flower that was available for resale in a recreational store was grown in a petri dish, and this is what grew out, sir. And you can read all that and learn all about it on
Cannabis gave you
some. On that was, I mean, I can leave anything. I can get a piece of bread on my loaf right now, and it's fine. But if I leave it out long enough, it's going to mold. So
that's why we need to grow our own instead of leaving it in the system for 6 months, sir.
That was what I was looking for. Thank you.
Thank you for your clarification.
Thank you.
And, sir, I'm Representative Hart. I'm a fervent Christian person. Christ is about compassion. I was not cussing. Thank you, sir.
Further questions for the witness? Thank you for your testimony. Further witnesses in favor of the legislation?
My name is Ethan Pampy. I'm a resident of Columbia, Missouri. I've been a resident of Missouri since 1993. In the last 2 years, I have worked for the state legal medical marijuana companies, Yukon Patient Group in San Bernardino, California, and Local Product of Denver, Colorado. The latter being a regulated, the former being an unregulated operation due to the nature of the laws in the states. In Columbia, I've been working for several years on behalf of marijuana law reform. And recently forced the resignation of my city councilwoman, Jenny Chadwick, over a broken promise to support a ordinance to decriminalize the cultivation of 6 marijuana plants in the city limits of Columbia. It's in this 6. It is with this context and this knowledge and education that I come to you in support of this legislation, and I hope to inform you of the challenges facing my community that this legislation could address. The argument I made to the citizens of Columbia when the City Council was considering our ordinance was that relaxing the penalties on people growing marijuana at home was twofold. Number one, that there is an inevitable demand, and particularly from people using marijuana for therapeutic purposes. And second, that the only current access being through a black market created dangers for consumers, to great danger from both unregulated product as and also through violent criminals. It's obviously not the only reason for you to support this bill, but it needs to be considered. This bill, by providing a legal outlet for at least some of the market demand for marijuana in Missouri, will decrease the economic incentives that drive persistent violence in the black market. In Columbia, we know that there are 3 to 6 deaths a year because of marijuana deals gone. In 2014, Derek Perkins, Anthony Unger, and Dante Tolstoy were all killed in Columbia in marijuana deals. In the Columbia Tribune, defense attorney Jennifer Bukowski, who was representing an individual charged with Dante Tolson's death, said that she believes if not for marijuana prohibition, Tolson's death would not have happened, and that this case was a byproduct of the war on drugs. Obviously, this affects law enforcement as well. My friend and colleague, Ken Burton, who is the police chief of Columbia, Missouri, has often expressed publicly in conversation to his desire that law enforcement get out of the business of policing marijuana use and commerce and focus on the business of protecting the persons and properties of the citizens they serve. Law enforcement resources are implicated in 2 ways by the current laws. Officers have to both enforce law against marijuana consumers, and that includes medical marijuana patients, and deal with the crimes of violent criminals taking advantage of the black market. By providing a regulated market and protocols for legal consumption, you would eliminate or at least decrease the liability facing otherwise law-abiding consumers to decrease the number of transactions occurring in the black market, reducing the risk of robbery, assault, and murder. Because of these reasons, it is likely that Columbia voters will soon send another ordinance to the City Council, and if that fails, take the initiative process to decriminalize small-scale household marijuana cultivation, and it is likely this legislation will pass. The committee may not be aware of the 2004 campaign to decriminalize marijuana possession in Columbia. That passed with 62% of the vote. I imagine that the support for this ordinance in a presidential election cycle, at the very least, would be at a similar level. This expansion of consumption, Columbia's decriminalization ordinance is legal, but my friend Ken Burton, who's a police chief, has expressed that there will be some costs. There will be some difficulty as the police department finds a way to navigate that decriminalization ordinance and the state law, even if it changes to the bill that Representative Pinson has proposed. In this spirit, I advise you to seriously consider further amendments, including the homegrown provision, as a means of increasing access through this home cultivation process and decrease the legal liability of medical consumers. We trust physicians to regulate the use of drugs under their care, and empowering that relationship should be a fundamental duty of this program. I'm open for questions, and particularly I recall there were questions about the business operations compliance of state-regulated marijuana dispensaries, and I'm prepared to address at least some of those questions from my experience in California, Colorado, and I've also seen medical laws implemented in Washington, Oregon, and other states, including Massachusetts.
Questions for the witness?
And I'll be emailing my testimony to the committee since I don't have a physical copy.
Seeing none, thank you for testimony. Further witnesses in favor?
Hello, my name is Lance Blatt. I'm in Missouri. And last year I was diagnosed with stage 4 Hodgkin's lymphoma. And with 6 months of chemotherapy, in remission now, things are going pretty good.
Can you speak a little closer to the mic, sir? I'm sorry, I'm hard of hearing.
Yeah, I apologize.
Thank you.
So 6 months of chemotherapy, and I'm in remission, I'm doing well. During my treatment, my doctor, since from Columbia, we have decriminalized the medical use, and he recommended the medical marijuana, which I found extremely beneficial in treating the symptoms of the chemotherapy. That's really about all I have to say. Try not to tie the doctor's hands who want to ease the patient's suffering. A lot of patients would probably continue their chemotherapy if they could manage the symptoms, which marijuana, the medical marijuana, does help. If you have any questions.
Thank you for your testimony. Representative Hansen.
I have to inquire.
Go ahead.
The doctor recommended it, you said, for you to use it. Have you used it?
Yes, sir.
Outcome's been good?
Yes.
Okay. How long since you had your last chemo treatment?
It has been about 7 months.
7 months ago, so how often do you use it to help your pain? Or?
I use it as needed.
Further questions for the witness? Seeing none, thank you for your testimony. Anyone further to testify in favor? Well, that only took 2 hours. Anyone to testify in opposition? I'm going to show hands. How many here to testify in opposition? One, two. Two in opposition. Okay.
Ed Moses, a private citizen, and I'm bringing with you some handout. Unfortunately, my colored printer wouldn't work, so if you need to send to someone electronically that you can share what I'm going to share with you, then I'll be happy to do that. Basically, I spent 41 years in... I was going to talk for a minute and then give it to you if that's okay. Again, thanks for allowing the time to speak on this. I spent 41 years in law enforcement, and I certainly am acquainted with people asking for help. Many times when you arrive on the scene, you have several people asking, screaming for help, and it's a lot of confusion, a lot of emotion. But knowing that you have to keep your wits about you, that you have to be professional, you have to protect the scene, you have to set up priorities, or people die. Or people get hurt unnecessarily. I look at this the same way. There's a lot of emotion here. There's a lot of caring compassion about doing the best thing. And as I was preparing to testify for you, I pulled up a federal appellate court ruling that came out January 22nd, 2013. And what the lawsuit was about was three marijuana groups that were suing DEA that they should reclassify marijuana out of Schedule 1. The Schedule 1 says no medical benefit and a high risk of harm to the public. What the ruling of that body was that upheld an earlier U.S. Supreme Court, their finding was because these factual findings reasonably support the agency's final decision not to reschedule marijuana, we must uphold the agency. They said that one of the strong criteria was proving that the medicine worked, the efficacy of the medicine, that it worked, it was safe. They said those challenging the government have not pointed to adequate and well-controlled studies confirming the efficacy of marijuana for medical uses. And basically, a drug has to be safe and effective, but it also has to be stable. And what I would ask a doctor, any doctor, is you look at a plant, not hundreds of plants, not thousands of plants, but tell me what part of that plant you would pick a bag best suited for your client's illness. And they won't be able to do it, because no person on earth knows that. And that bag will change in a matter of hours, because marijuana is unstable. If I buy a medicine on the East Coast, it's the same medicine on the West Coast. It's the same medicine next month. Marijuana isn't the same from different parts of the plant, or the different varieties of the plant, or certainly each different crop, and so each dose has changed. Anyone that knows anything about science, your outcome's going to change. We also derive medicines from bread mold, botulism, horse urine, and as earlier testified, a little tree bark. But we don't use it in its raw form. We use it in a stable form that's been proved safe and effective. I brought a list to leave with you, and I'll only name the names and not read the quotes, save time. But the different medical societies that are on record that have written oppose medical marijuana. American Society for Addictive Medicine, American Cancer Society, American Glaucoma Foundation, which also says that if a glaucoma patient would use that, they would have to smoke it every 2 hours. If you don't and the pressure returns, you might do further damage to the eye. This is a concern. We don't want to go in and do something we're not sure that science agrees and only add problems instead of solving. National Multiple Sclerosis Society, the American Academy of Pediatrics, American Medical Association, American Psychiatric Association, and the National School Nurses Association. Then to expedite, I brought a document that's 2 pages for you to look over. And one area talks about FDA approval and the protocol of medical research and use. The second one talks about the medical marijuana, the same criteria. And the third talks about marijuana-based medicines. That we all hope there are thousands of things coming from marijuana-based medicine. But it won't be in its crude form. It'll be in research to prove safe, effective, and specific in the way that we do all medicines. This is the chart that I wanted to come out in color and did not. And this shows our 50 states and the states that are at the very top of saturation, the highest percent of marijuana usage by children of age 12 to 17 are all the medical marijuana states. I know the intent here is well placed. Everyone is concerned about doing the best we can for anyone that's needing help. But the key word here is the best. And we have pharmaceuticals on the scope, like CBD oil, that we could brought here with FDA approval, DEA approval by GW Pharmaceuticals. It was even so good medical protocol research, the insurance company said we insure it. It goes from their pharmacy to the doctor's pharmacy to the doctor to the patient with a double-blind study to see if it is effective. That was turned down in favor of growing our own, extracting an oil at each dose. And I talked with the sponsor of the Senate, and he admitted to me he knows each dose will be different on the raw form of that plant. I spent a week out in Colorado for the Colorado Chiefs of Police Association. And we had 500 law enforcement-related people there, 3 countries, and 3 days of intense looking at the Colorado problem. And what you're hearing is not near what the horrible problem is out there. And they described it as a wild west. They said the only reason it passed is we didn't think it would pass. And each speaker that presented there, and some were from the marijuana industry, said they didn't know what was in the bill when it was passed. They don't know what they're going to do with black molar allergens that are hazardous to families because there's no mandatory reporting that you're a grow house. and there's no quality control, that you're not contaminating the house for the people that come in after you, or the whole building that they would be using. And the governor himself said it was a mistake. And the people out there that were working on it and trying to control it and trying to regulate it said the gray market and the black market is out of control. The only one they're hoping to get a handle on is the legal market, and it's out of control. I went in a shop, walked up, told them, you know, I was from Missouri, wanted to see what they were selling there. And the kid said, well, I'll have to give you a slip that you're out of state because in-state can buy more stuff, and he can buy stronger stuff. And when he found out I was from Missouri, he said, oh, I'm from there, scratched it out and put in there that I was from Colorado so I could buy more and stronger. And when I went in there, I started talking to the caregiver about the CB1, CB2 receptors and what it does to the hippocampus and the basal ganglia in the brain and how I wanted to balance it out with what I was dealing with. And he said, use some, see how it does. If it doesn't work, do some more. That was my medical diagnosis. No, I did not buy any, nor did I use any. I just went in there to prove that while they say they are regulating, it's really not. It's all about legalization in the end for those that have been behind it since I worked undercover in 1972. I went to their meetings. I listened to their strategy. And unfortunately, people who are well-intended and want to do something for other people, this contaminates. And we have a method to get safe medicine coming from marijuana if we choose to use it. And I'll answer any questions you like.
Briefly, do you have a specific objection with the bill, or do you just have a general objection with any sort of legalization of marijuana?
I have no objection to proper medical protocol going through the FDA new drug unit. I do have a problem on us voting on science and circumventing protocol that's put there to keep us safe and effective, yes.
So your concern is that we're doing it as a state, not on the federal level?
No, I have a concern that we're not going through medical science protocol, that we're not using the safeguards to make sure that what we put out there is truly, specifically for that illness, it's safe and it works. And I'm tickled over getting the CBD oil. I have a grandson that has seizures. I have friends and family that have some of the cancer, some of the problems that we're facing. But I want best medical practice for them.
Further questions for the witness? Yes.
Representative Hicks.
To inquire, please. Back a little bit, you talked about the court cases and things like that. I'm just curious, do we have a date of the last time that this was heard in a court or was struck down being used as a medical purpose? Because I know we have patents for medical uses on it, but if a court struck it out, I'd like to know the last time. I know times have changed. If it was, you know, 1970 or 80 or whatever, I know our medical, not just medical, but
I believe the U.S. Supreme Court was around in 2001. However, the one on the federal appellate level I quoted was January 22nd, 2013.
Thank you for your time, sir. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Further questions for the witness? Seeing none, thank you for your testimony.
Thank you.
Further witnesses, I suppose.
Good evening. I'm Jason Grellner. I am the past president of the Missouri Narcotics Officers Association, current vice president of the National Narcotics Officers Association, and I am speaking in opposition to the bill, somewhat for the same reasons and some for different reasons than Mr. Moses. Name one other drug in the history of the United States we have legislated and not used science on, name one, that we bypassed the FDA on. That we went around the FDA to determine the benefits and risks of the drug. That we went around the FDA to determine how it may interact with other drugs. That we went around the FDA to assure standardization of the drug. That we went around the FDA to determine the appropriate dosage levels of the drug. Ask any doctor in this state what the dosage of, and the amount of THC for a 220-pound man with any disease. Identify and monitor the side effects of the drug. Identify safe drug administration. Is it safe to smoke it? Is it safe to vaporize it? Is it safe to eat it? Do we have science that proves that? There have been some stories in here of people who have used this drug and explained that it has helped them in their specific area, in their specific disease state at that time in their life. In Colorado, who started as a medical marijuana state in 2001, after it passed in 2000, they thought they had built the best bill in the country with tight constraints on medical marijuana. In 2001, it went into effect. By 2010, after a lawsuit by those that wanted full legalization of marijuana, they lost control of the bill that they had passed. 94% of people who were receiving medical marijuana in Colorado in 2010 were receiving it for pain management, 4% for cancer, HIV, AIDS, and glaucoma, and another 39% for other conditions. In Hawaii, 85% for pain, 2% for cancer, HIV, AIDS, glaucoma, 35% for other. Some of these will add up to more than 100 because they were getting diagnosed with pain and another. In Rhode Island, 64% for pain, 16% for HIV, AIDS, glaucoma, 31% for other. Oregon, 90% for pain, 7% for cancer, HIV, AIDS, glaucoma. This is not a prescription. A doctor in the state, United States of America, cannot prescribe a Schedule I drug. Supreme Court has ruled that they can recommend things. That's why it's a recommendation. It is not a prescription. They will lose their DEA number and license if they prescribe a Schedule I drug. That is why in Colorado, 50% of the 108,000 marijuana patients were getting their prescriptions from 12 doctors. So on average, each of those doctors was seeing 4,500 patients. 12 doctors, 50% of the prescribing. Because ask yourself this, what insurance company is going to insure a doctor who is recommending a drug that's not FDA approved? Is that going to be our best and our brightest doctors? Most cardholders in California and Colorado, greater than 80% of them, are white men between the ages of 17 and 35 with no history of chronic illness and a history of alcohol and drug abuse. 80% of them. You can build this as tight as you want. Whenever they find something they don't like in Colorado. Colorado law said in the beginning that a caregiver could only have 5 patients. They didn't like that. Just like there's parts of this bill they don't like. They sued. Said, you don't have the right to tell me how many patients I can have. You don't tell any other doctor or caregiver how many patients they can have. And they won. Up until 2006, 2009, there were about 5,000 or 6,000 medical marijuana cards in Colorado. Lawsuit started in 2006, ended in 2009. By 2010, there were 108,000 marijuana patients. And one caregiver was a caregiver for 1,200 patients. If there is a loophole or a way to exploit this law, they will do it. Imagine now that you have a caregiver in Missouri with 1,200 patients and 2.5 ounces per patient. How much marijuana that individual can have in his vehicle or home? 74% of kids showing up at addiction treatment. And this is prior to becoming recreational. We don't even have the full recreational numbers yet. 74% of kids showing up at treatment centers when it was just medical marijuana in Colorado said that 9 out of 10 times they used somebody else's medical marijuana. If this is medicine, why are we so worried about where we put these dispensaries? There are laws in the state about a Walgreens being next to a school, or a CVS, or a Rite Aid, or a Schnucks. See any laws about that? If this is truly medicine, what are you worried about? Why does it matter how close it is to a school or a daycare? This is medicine. There are several medications that are going through the FDA process at the current time. Those are the patents. And patents are patented by companies that don't want them stolen by other companies while they're going through the process, so that they can get FDA quality controls. So that when I get a Vicodin at the Walgreens in Florida, it's the same Vicodin that I get in St. Louis. When I get an antibiotic in New York, it's the same antibiotic I get in Phoenix. We don't use politics to bypass science. We don't politicize something into a medicine. You want to do something? Write letters, write bills demanding that we have money out there for companies like GW Pharmaceuticals to fast-track their drugs so that we're sure that when an epileptic 12-year-old gets his medication, it comes through the FDA process and he's being given medication, not something that was grown who knows where and what pesticide was used on it, what mold was growing on it. And if he's getting the same medicine that he got 2 weeks ago. Because we don't have an FDA in Missouri that can go around and do all of that. And when you pass these kinds of legislations and we start talking about, why don't we let them grow it at home? Does that mean that you give up your right to search and seizure? Is your Fourth Amendment gone? Because how, as a law enforcement officer, do I know if you're growing 6, 12, or 100? So if we're going to let them grow it at home, either they give up their Fourth Amendment rights, or I now have to get a search warrant on a misdemeanor. You ever tried that? Ain't going to happen. So growing it at home, if you're going to give them 6, you might as well give them 1,000, because there's no way we're going to enforce that. Is that what you want? Because they'll sue for that too, like they did in Colorado, saying that, well, 6 isn't enough for me because I have to make edibles and I have to do the extract of the plant. And oh, by the way, if I'm using BHO and I blow up my house and my neighbor's house, that was just an accident. There's a lot more to this to talk about than people that are in pain. And Lord knows, we need to do everything we can to make sure that those people get medicine, not antidotes about how this helped me. True medicine. We need to put money behind medicine. Has science on the marijuana plant lagged behind that on the opium plant? It sure has, but we don't have medical opium. We have extracts and synthetics of the plant that have gone through FDA process and have been proven to be medicine. Same thing with Epidiolex, which is CBD oil, that's going through and showing right now about 24% usefulness. Why don't we put some money here in the state to give hospitals like Children's and Cardinal Glennon the ability to get in on that so that patients get the medication for free and are part of a study so that all children can get it someday and not just the ones that can afford to buy it from a dispensary. Like, I can talk for 4 days on this if you want, but I know that there's other things we need to get to. By the way, do we put a sales tax on any other medicine? Do we? Or do you think that's another point we can sue on if we're on the other side? How do you pay federal income tax if you own a dispensary? Because it's illegal at the federal level. You've been here a long time. Any questions?
Questions for the witness?
Yes.
Representative Michael.
Well, it sounds like basically your testimony is that you're saying that if we pass this, it's going to be dangerous.
It's going to be very dangerous.
To the people. Because of the end.
It's going to be dangerous to the patients and it's going to be dangerous to our youth. Every state that has a medical marijuana law leads the United States in youth use rates. tech in Colorado was doing that before they became recreational.
If this was, if this marijuana product was sent through FDA and the government approved it, then you would change your opinion?
Then it's a drug, like Marinol, like Sativex, like Cannabidiol, like the other, like the total of four drugs that have already made it through FDA testing.
In your experience, have you heard or experienced any of those situations where in other states where it is legal, has there been an increase in misuse of it?
Like I said, every state with medical marijuana leads the country in youth use rates. Every state, the 23 states are in the top 24 states of youth use. And you only have to look to Colorado. And I'm telling you, folks, we're talking about Colorado, pre-legalization. This is Colorado medical marijuana. This is, we have the best law in the United States until we get sued out of it. And there are point after point after point that can be attacked. Because if you want to treat it like medicine, then you need to treat it like every other medicine.
Well, I ask you these questions because this is what I've asked my constituents, and I come down here like most of the other representatives here to represent the people in their district. Whether they're totally uneducated about it or how they feel about it, I guess it's all across the board, but I'm asking those questions because that's what they're asking me.
Well, and I know that there was a form passed around about, that marijuana is good for stroke. I saw it today, and yet I brought with me, came out on the February the 20th from the American Heart Association that says smoking marijuana can cause strokes, and if you've had a stroke and smoke marijuana, it like doubles your chances of having another stroke. So there, you get all of this information. But then when you go to the societies that are in charge of this, like the American Cancer Society, who says raw marijuana is not to be used with their patients. This is the American Cancer Society.
I think some of my constituents are afraid of what this can lead to, you know, and they've asked me about it. And I said, well, you know, the only thing I know about it is what I hear and what people say, and I think they're concerned about, you know, the misuse of it. One constituent was asking me that she works in drug courts, and now we're getting kind of away from the medical use of it, but she was telling me that a lot of these young kids are being solicited to sell, meth products and such, and a lot of them come in that have been using marijuana. Where are they getting it? Is it homegrown? Is it safe? Is it unsafe? And then when they have treatment, and then all of a sudden those kids come back again, they're using some other stuff. So looking at it from a standpoint of making it more readily available from a legal standpoint, would you think that maybe we would see more people using it illegally?
Certainly. People regard legal with safe. The government wouldn't legalize it if it wasn't safe.
Well, that's...
That's how synthetics work.
Well, that's the concerns that I have, and I was just wanting to clarify that, because my answer to them was, I don't know, I'll check on it. I'm glad you presented information. I can take this back to them and tell them. Thank you. Thank you,
Chairman. Other questions for the witness? Representative Hanson?
I have to inquire.
Go ahead.
How much fraudulent purchases would you say takes place in Colorado under the guise of medical marijuana?
None anymore, because they've gone to full legalization, which okay. is why two other states, two private citizens, and the last seven DEA commanders are now suing the state of Colorado.
Okay, I knew that was going on. What do you see that? You see fraud as an issue going from one care center to another.
When you have a caregiver who's representing 1,200 people, do you think there might be some fraud there?
Yeah.
Again, 2.5 ounces times 1,200 people.
Is there any tracking of that in any way, of how that? that's...
We don't even track schedule 2 through 4 in this state yet.
Further questions for the witness? Seeing none, thank you for your testimony.
Thank you.
Anyone else testify in opposition? Seeing none, how many are here to testify for informational purposes? 2. Go ahead.
Hello, my name is Daryl Bertrand. I'm from Ozark, Missouri. First of all, I'd like to thank you for having this hearing, as it is such an important issue in the state of Missouri. 23 states, plus Washington, D.C., have initiated medical cannabis programs, either through petition initiative or legislative action. This issue is pressing in Missouri because every day we lose hardworking, productive Missourians to other states that have taken the courageous action to allow medical treatments to be decided by the patient and physician, not the bureaucrats. In my particular situation, standard pharmaceutical treatments to deal with chronic pain caused by spinal stenosis, spondylolisthesis, and degenerative disc disease left me hospitalized and near death. As a former medical cannabis patient, I can attest how I was able to control my pain, function in society, own my own business, raise my family, and live the American dream. While I appreciate the spirit behind this bill, as a former business owner, I understand the need to regulate the industry, but I also ask that you take the special care in not over-regulating the industry. This bill, as written, will hamper the entrepreneur spirit in Missouri. Patients will continue to seek the black market for cannabis therapy or continue to flee the state, as over-regulation will not allow them to pay for the dispensary pricing, or the limited amount of dispensaries will make access unattainable. 14 states have allowed home cultivation of cannabis plants for patients. This allows the patient the ability to provide the medicine they need for themselves rather than depending on medical programs designed to make the people dependent on the government. Thank you for taking the time and interest in this very important topic. I'd also like to point out there's been a lot of misinformation tonight, and I welcome you all to research stuff on your own. Very troubling statistics were misrepresented tonight also. What's troubling is Colorado does not, the teen use in Colorado, according to the CDC, as of 2014, Colorado leads the nation in teen use decline. There's other factions that are very important to me. There's disparity clauses. Patients who can't afford their medicine, how are they going to attain it? They will not be able to under this bill. They will continue to suffer, and they will die. But in hindsight, if you guys can help one person in this bill and they can live, please do it. That's all I have.
Questions for the witness? Seeing none, thank you for your testimony. One final witness for informational purposes.
Honorable Chairman, members of the committee, Representative Henson, thank you for allowing me to speak this evening. My name is Matt Cook. I am the former Senior Director of Enforcement for the Colorado Department of Revenue. I am also 35-year career law enforcement person, retired, and the architect of Colorado Medical Marijuana Act through House Bill 10-1284. I currently own Cook Consulting LLC, and I've assisted a number of legislative bodies throughout the United States with this public policy decision to move forward with a cannabis bill or not, and I've also assisted a number of those venues also with the promulgation of their rules, making recommendations in terms of what works and what doesn't. With that said, I want to make it very clear that I was responsible for the drafting of the medical law in Colorado only. Subsequent to that bill, the recreation bill was passed by a vote of the people. That was not something that I endorse. I don't endorse use of any substance that alters your state of mind unless it's for medical purposes, period. With that said, what you have before you, the Missouri Compassionate Care Act, is probably the 6th, 8th, or 10th generation of a very sound basic regulatory purpose or regulatory scheme or process that's used throughout the United States. As you've heard, in a number of states, approximately half the United States now has some form of medical marijuana law. We've come a very, very, very long way since the promulgation of HB 10-1284 in Colorado. This bill contains a number of proven best regulatory practices utilized throughout the United States, and they work. This bill is not the Colorado experience. We've certainly come a long way since the passage of HB 10-1284. I'll also tell you, during the promulgation of the rules associated with that, traditional law enforcement was very much at the table. The chiefs of police, the sheriff's association, the Colorado Drug Investigators Association worked very closely with them, district attorney's counsel as well, to promulgate the rules. I do believe that the passage of the Recreational Act in the state of Colorado truly has tainted that process and created another nightmare. This law, you may recall that last year you had a hemp oil bill that passed. I was also involved with that process. And at the end of my testimony in committee, I was asked if there was one thing I could change with the passage of HB 10-1284, based on what we've learned today, what would it be? My answer then and my answer today would be, obviously, to limit the number of licenses. This bill certainly does do that, limits it to geographical locations, to the number of 30. The other thing that it does, and I think we've learned a lot throughout the United States, is it prohibits commercially packaged cakes, candies, or cookies from distribution, those that are infused with cannabis. From the time you're 5 years old or so, when your mother or a relative would give you a cake, a candy, or a cookie, you were taught to eat and consume the entire product. I am led to believe that if you do that in the cannabis world, that it may end up giving you a very long nap. I'm not a cannabis user, so I can't speak to that firsthand. Nonetheless, there have been a number of issues raised this evening. I'd like to speak to a number of them. Again, I've assisted a number of venues throughout the United States. I can speak to what that global landscape looks like throughout the United States, and I'm happy to do so. The first was whether or not there's been an assertion made that the youth access and usage of medical marijuana increases in those medical regulatory states. I'm aware of three specific studies. The Journal of Adolescent Health, December 13, 2013, did a 10-year study that did not find an increase by youth in those states that had medical marijuana laws. Science Daily, on April 23, 2014, last year, used 20 years of data, found that states with medical regulatory schemes did not lead to an increase of marijuana use by youth. And you heard from a prior person testifying here that the Colorado Department of Public Health and Environment issued some statistics that showed that the use of marijuana by Colorado high school students decreased from 22% to 20%, and that is true. It is, in fact, a true fact. I want to address a number of your policy concerns. There's been a number of questions, particularly around caregivers. Caregivers are a huge problem in Colorado, and they are in a number of states. In Colorado, caregivers were born in our Constitution through Amendment 20. That was a 2000 amendment. Created a patient-caregiver relationship and allowed caregivers to grow or cultivate up to 6 plants for each patient. As a detective testified to, at that point in time, there were no limitations on the number of patients. There was, in fact, a lawsuit that was filed. The health department was then directed to promulgate rules to put some limitations surrounding the caregivers, and along comes the David Ogden memorandum in 2009, a Deputy United States Attorney General, which essentially said they would allow, as long as the industry was in clear and unambiguous compliance with state law, that they would not be an enforcement priority. The industry interpreted that to be a tacit approval, and overnight we had 1,200 establishments in the state of Colorado. Huge public outcry, as you can imagine, and as a result, I was given a 22-page bill and told that I was going to regulate that industry. The bill candidly didn't do much to regulate the industry, and I had the dubious honor of communicating with the bill sponsor and letting him know that that was obviously a problem. It's never a fun thing to do, I freely admit. But nonetheless, we put our heads together and we came up with something that we believed provided basic regulatory parameters around that industry in the state of Colorado, using specific proven regulatory strategies that are used in a number of other industries, be it liquor, gaming, pharmaceutical industry, you pick one. They're all present in that that bill. The caregivers, however, had constitutional protection and believed that they didn't have to report. Consequently, in House Bill 10-1284, we limited caregivers to 5 patients. Further, there was a huge public safety issue created because caregivers typically grow in their homes. Well, the lights that are used to cultivate these products are very hot. Typically, they're grown in basements, there's no ventilation, and there was a huge fire hazard created. Again, we passed legislation that required compliance with local building and electrical fire codes in an effort to try and curtail the caregiver's experience on the cultivation side to no avail. There's still a number of caregivers out there who believe they have constitutional protection and will not report where their grows are being, where they're growing their products. So having a caregiver's ability to grow, which your legislation proposal does not provide for, can be problematic. There was the other thing I want to point out is those in the regulatory arena, as you found out this evening, have to pay fairly substantial license fees. They're subject to hours of operation. They have to be subject to all the regulatory tenants. They give up their basic Fourth Amendment protection as a condition of licensure. They are subject to inspections at any time during any current business activity. It's all listed in your bill. Caregivers, on the other hand, don't have to deal with those issues. And so you put the licensed regulated arena at a huge disadvantage by allowing a caregiver to cultivate without being subject to the same regulatory principles that the licensed arena would be subject to. The other thing I would point out is licenses are unique to a person and a place in this legislation. And that's done for a reason. You have hours of operation that allow operation during the day. There's regulatory oversight, obviously, that you will have a staff that will deal with that. Not allowing or allowing caregivers to do it at any time at will, obviously, is a huge economic advantage, and it does definitely feed the black market. This bill contains some very stout industry testing practices, and I would tell you that they came from the state of Nevada. The state of Nevada has the most strict regulatory testing protocol of any state in the United States currently. There was testimony earlier about the need to test for contaminants, pesticides, molds, mildews. All those things are contained in the bill currently, and I applaud the fact that the state of Missouri wants to make that happen, let testing occur before they allow it to be sold. One of the things I would point out is a best practice that Arizona has employed that deals with the issue of caregivers, if that remains a concern for this body. And that is, they have exempt caregivers or will allow a caregiver to service its patients, a limited number of patients, as long as there is not a retail outlet within a certain number of miles from the residence. So it might be something to consider on down the road. Personally, I wouldn't do the caregiver side of things. It's a matter. There was some discussion about or questions about the ability to distribute cannabis from a pharmacy. As you've heard, cannabis is a Schedule I controlled substance. The DEA issues licenses to pharmacies, and they're C2 through C5, or Schedule 2 through 5 license, and you're prohibited from having a Schedule I controlled substance on a Schedule 2 through 5 licensed premises. You will definitely jeopardize your DEA registration. License fees. There were a number of comments about the license fees and the non-refundable application fees. This bill is set up like many other states in that it establishes a cash fund, and that cash fund was generated, as in most states, I would imagine, to provide funding for the regulatory oversight. Somebody's going to have to do a very extensive background investigation on all of your applicants. You need to raise the bar in terms of who has the ability to apply for these licenses. I can tell you Connecticut and New York have a $2 million bond requirement or suitability of at least $2 million in liquid assets to move forward with an application for license. Those fees
are necessary to enable a staff to do an adequate background investigation on all of your applicants. It's an ongoing process. I believe the bill also provides that the cash fund should be looked at on an annual basis and the fees adjusted accordingly to make it revenue neutral. There was some discussion about what kind of revenues do these businesses generate. Candidly, that depends on a number of factors, and I don't know that there is any hard, you know, data out there. If there is, I think I could probably give you data that would say it's probably not accurate. But what I do want to point out, and I would encourage you to investigate, is something called the 280E rule, the 280E tax rule. It's an IRS provision, resulted in a lawsuit many, many years ago, which essentially said these businesses cannot take a tax deduction for selling, a federal tax deduction for selling substances that are considered a Schedule I or illegal pursuant to federal law. They are, in essence, getting double taxed. There's no way around it. The federal government requires payment, and many of these places have to pay in cash. They don't have the ability to use traditional banking services, and they're being penalized because they have to pay in cash. They can't follow the IRS guidelines. But that's the federal government's stance on this. Again, a number of states have passed legislation that allow for traditional banking, but the banking facilities are either regulated by the FDIC or the CNUA under the federal government, and that can cause problems as well. The federal government won't allow it. In terms of the $500,000 liquidity requirement, this is an extremely expensive industry to engage in. The cultivation side of things is very expensive and requires some form of financial stability as a condition to enter a market. Truly is one mechanism to keep them away from the black market or having to borrow from unsavory people that you may not want to be involved with this industry. There was questions about the distance restrictions and why are they there. I believe what you have in your bill almost comes almost word for word out of the Controlled Substances Act, and the federal government, the DEA, the United States attorneys have been very vocal about their stance on the establishment or location of these places within 1,000 feet of those institutions listed in your draft, and they have taken a number of actions. In Colorado, they issued letters. They were in 1,000 feet. They gave them 45 days to move or close, and on the 45th day, they meant business. They showed up at these businesses. The other thing I want to point out, there was some concern about the bill, the legislation that was passed last year, the hemp bill, and the CBD bill, and whether or not this legislation would be redundant to that legislation passed last year. It's the same plan. It's cannabis sativa. The difference is the hemp bill has a threshold of 0.3% THC. It has to have less than that. That bill specifically allowed treatment for only intractable epilepsy within the state of Missouri for Missourians. As you know, this legislation allows for the treatment of, you know, different disorders. Let's see. The dual licensing process. The dual licensing process really provides an opportunity for local government to have a say-so as to what type of business, the location, the number, the size, the impact on local government. Who knows better than local government what those kinds of conditions are? Within their own venue. The process would be that an applicant would make application to that local government, it would be approved, it would then be sent to the state, they would do their suitability determination. And there are different interests between local and state government. I can say that with authority because I work for both local and state government in my career. We see things differently. The bill does also provide for something called a concurrent review, which allows both the state and local governments to review the application at the same time and deal with those issues so that there's not an extra cog in the wheel, if you will. I would say there were some questions about doctors in the state of Colorado and the abuse by the MDs. There was abuse by the MDs with the passage of House Bill 10-1284. That abuse was answered by another Senate, Senate Bill 109. You can Google that. You'll see there were many parameters, many protections put in place. But I would also tell you that over 800 doctors in the state of Colorado have recommended the use of cannabis as a medicine, and that's on record as well. So the abuses were dealt with very early on. The protections were in place, or are in place, in your draft bill that prohibits kickbacks, financial interest in the centers. This is a good iteration of something that's been in place for a very long time with proven regulatory strategies. Any questions that I can answer for the committee?
Questions for the witness, Representative Hansen.
How much would you say this has cost the state of Colorado to administer all this from a taxpayer standpoint? Is there a fiscal note, what I'm looking for?
There is.
This is huge to me.
Representative Hansen, as with this legislation, we were authorized one FTE, one investigative FTE, for every 10 licenses. Now, if you do the math of 1,100, we had 110 authorized FTE. We never got even close to that for a variety of reasons. And right now, I believe they have about 35 FTE with 2,200 plus licenses in the state of Colorado.
So, what was the dollar-wise?
The fiscal cost, I believe, initially was around $8 million a year, initially. I don't have any idea. I retired 3.5 years ago, so I'm not sure what the costs are today. But the fiscal note would be available, absolutely.
Representative Taylor? Go ahead.
I'll follow up real quick on Representative Hansen's comment. The fiscal note, the amount that is paid to pay these FTEs comes from the licensing fees and that sort of thing. It doesn't come from state general revenue, is that right?
The medical model as initially set up, that's correct. It came from license fees. Subsequent to that, they have combined the medical and the recreational units into one unit, and there is about a 30% tax, excise tax, if you will, sales tax, that's lobbied or levied on all cannabis that's sold on a recreation site to fund. A lot of that money is used to fund the program.
And Representative Hansen, that's how you've got it set up here. I believe there's language in there that says no money from general revenue shall be spent on the inspectors or the investigators. Did I read that right?
It all comes from the fees, not come from general revenue.
It's all self-generating. Okay.
Those are one-time fees, aren't they?
No, they're annual fees. There's annual fees.
They're annual fees, yes. The $25,000.
That's an application fee.
That's an application. That's a one-time fee.
Correct. I mean, I read it too. It is my inquiry. I also wanted to make a point. There was somebody, just for the committee's information, there was somebody that testified. I can't remember exactly how they said it, but it was, you know, there was one doctor who had treated 1,200 patients in a year, so obviously that's evidence of fraud. I quickly texted my wife, who's a nurse practitioner at a cancer center, and I said, just out of curiosity, how many patients do you treat a year? And she said somewhere between 2,500 and 4,000. So there are people out there who are prescribing medication, chemo, radiation, a host of other things, and there's not a whole lot of fraud associated with that. So just for the committee's input. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Representative Bond.
You too inquired, Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
To follow up on the point that the representative just made, you had said at the end of your statement that you believe that there was widespread fraud from the doctors.
Actually, there were four doctors who were brought before the Board of Medical Examiners in the state of Colorado, and I believe they did lose their licenses to practice.
So there were at least four. Ask a few quick questions. After the initial bill, which says you were the architect of the bill, you talked about how the state boards had to promulgate new rules on the number of people that each caregiver could. Is that correct?
No, that was actually put in House Bill 1284.
Okay. There were new rules promulgated in terms of fire codes because of the growing.
Correct.
There were federal mandates that came down in terms of federal decisions from people who talked about whether or not they were going to come in as the federal government shut these shops down. Is that correct? There was a person's name that you said?
There were actually, we call them
1,000-foot letters. They were all related to distance restrictions.
But no, you said there was a gentleman's name. There was a gentleman, a federal attorney.
Oh, yes. I'm sorry. That was David Ogden, the Deputy United States Attorney. Yes.
He put down even more of a sort of a federal position or decision on that.
The 2009 memorandum that the Deputy United States Attorney General issued, David Ogden, again said that somebody asked for the stance of the federal government on the states that were issuing medical cannabis licenses. The response was that the federal government would not make them an enforcement priority as long as they were in clear and unambiguous compliance with state law. And the industry interpreted that as a tacit approval, and we had 1,100 businesses overnight.
So then that caused 1,100 more businesses. Then you talked about after your first bill that there was an additional House bill that was passed to help correct some of these things. Is that?
There is a bill currently in the legislature in the state of Colorado to clean up on the medical side.
A cleanup?
To clean up, yeah. They're addressing some of the labeling issues. Packaging issues.
There was also a cleanup that you talked about, Senate Bill 109.
Senate Bill 109 was
helped clean up as well, is that correct?
Senate Bill 109 was passed only to deal with the doctor or the pot doctor issue, if you will, to set some parameters and prohibitions that would not allow doctors to have a financial interest or get a pecuniary gain from recommendations to make patients.
Were any of these things you saw before you passed the bill?
They were actually concurrent with the bill and passed at the same time.
Okay, I guess I'm not making my, I guess I'm not asking the question the right way. You helped become the architect of this original bill. Did you foresee having to address fire codes, having to address Senate, having to create Senate Bill 109, having to create a new House bill to help clean this up when you drafted your initial bill?
We did not. The fire codes, yes, that was all part of our rulemaking, and anything to control or put additional controls, video security, all those kinds of things were part of that legislation. Senate Bill 109 had nothing to do with. I had no insight. It was not part of my regulatory challenge. I was just to deal with the establishment of the business itself.
Right. And you did make the statement. You think that we now have, we finally gotten it right. This bill gets it right.
You've got a few things you need to change, I think, but yes, you're getting there.
Would you please tell the committee which things you would like us to change? As the architect of this, I have to then ask you.
Well, it's a public policy decision as to what those things are, but my recommendations would be to eliminate the caregiver, not allow caregivers to plant any plants at all.
That's not in this bill, is it?
It is not in this bill, that's correct. I would put limitations on the numbers of plants that they could cultivate.
That who could cultivate?
That a licensed premises could cultivate.
Okay.
And that's something I know that there's been some discussion on. I would levy an excise tax on everything grown and earmark those funds for public safety to pay for the oversight, as well as fire. Both police and fire should be the recipient of those dollars, and they should be earmarked specifically for those programs.
Thank you. I appreciate that. No further questions, Mr. Chairman.
Any more questions for the witness? Thank you for your testimony. I believe that is all the witnesses. Representative Henson, do you want to read the witness?
Yes. First of all, I want to thank the committee members to sit through this little over 3-hour hearing. I appreciate it very much. I just want to end on this. At the beginning of this country, marijuana was legal. Politics got involved with it. So if anyone thinks that this isn't a political issue, it's always been a political issue once politicians got involved. What we can do here today is take a step forward for people that we know that are using it right now in the dark for their medical benefits and hopefully help more people out there. And I always tell people, my constituents, this. Whenever I press that button, whenever I vote, I try to think of you sitting in this chair, having as much information that I have and as much knowledge that I have on that bill, and you would vote the same way as I would with that education and information that you have. Committee members, thank you very much, and I look forward to working with you.
Thank you. I'm going to close the hearing.
have.